and have even bigger opinions.
Well, welcome back.
Welcome back, everyone. Madison had to quickly run out. She'll be back.
We'll be so back, but hey, happy Wednesday!
We have our girl, Hayes, is back.
Oh, she's back. Oh, my God. And okay, did the big too. Oh, my God.
Hi,
did
guys.
You like my intro?
Yeah,
I don't know if she heard
I
it.
Actually, I did, and you know what? I actually just wanted to make a dramatic entrance.
I
think that's just what I wanted to do, so yeah. I did it, and thank you.
It was great energy, honestly.
Thanks.
Like, Keely and I were sitting here before, and we're like, I'm so tired, but that just really it was on the spot.
You
we
know,
had to yeah. be ready.
It's like just the pink flash going. Just running right by you.
Yeah, seriously.
The pink flash
but
would be dead.
We have some great stuff to talk about today,
do.
Guys. Like,
we do.
Some very great stuff.
And unique stuff.
We
very
do.
Unique, very fun. It's going to be a great block for the girl gang today. So I want to start out with posing an opening question. I've seen this recently on Twitter. No. We've all been asked the hypothetical questions like, if you had to eat one meal for the rest of your life, what would it be? If you had to watch one movie for the rest of your life, what would it be? My question is, if you had to listen to one song for the rest of your life, what would it be? One song, not one artist, not one album, one song.
I have to pull up my Spotify and look at it for a second.
Apparently, this is a hot take, but mine's American Pie by Dawn McLean, and it's 9 minutes long. So honestly, like, come on, guys. You want to?
Can I
get a ring in my ears from hearing that?
A long, long time ago.
Oh. I know all
keep
9 minutes.
Please keep going.
No,
keep
I don't
going,
have a good
please.
Voice.
Oh, okay.
It's gonna be really
okay.
Embarrassing
okay.
When someone
but like, I just want to understand. Like, I maybe
me.
Just I that just I wasn't expecting that. A, I want to say, and then B, your reasoning originally was that it's 9 minutes. That's why you like it. But
yeah.
Can we get like a little more in depth? Because 9 minutes of something bad is almost worse
also,
than 3 minutes on repeat.
I definitely don't think it's
wait,
bad.
It's not
bad.
A bad song.
I just
it's
think
a
I
classic.
I think I would get a headache like after listening
yeah.
to that song.
Understandable. See, that's
come
not
on.
Okay, no, I like totally disagree. But also I ruin a lot of songs for myself because whenever I become obsessed with a song, literally I will play it nonstop. Mm. I cannot play another song. It's like my OCD or something. But like I can't play another song until
well,
like
I
get
yeah.
sick of that song.
No, that's very fair. I do that too. Like I will listen to the same like maybe 1 to 3 songs. Like when I get in the car, that's the first thing I put on and it will probably get played 1 or 2 more times after that. But I don't know if I could do my whole life. Because after about a couple months, like you said, I start to hate that song. Because I'm like, wow.
So
I
and I feel like
so
then you
much.
Have to be very selective.
That's what I'm saying. Like
when
I start thinking about my
music.
Whole life, I'm like, oh my gosh. Like right now, my current obsession is Sexy Can I by Ray J.
Oh my gosh.
Someone played it for me.
That's
like,
really niche. I don't think anyone else can say that one.
Somebody played it for me when I was like, pre-gaming to go out and I was like wait this is a banger so now every time I'm like sad I like
did you
I'm, like,
never
drive.
Hear that before
no I have but I haven't heard it in so
Sexy
long
kid.
The beat's good too I mean it's his only good song of all time but I don't think I'd want that to be my song for
get
life
lit on a Wednesday night to Sexy
yeah
Canada.
Like
see,
I don't
guys,
know about that like
imagine,
my whole life
imagine you're okay
I love Bryson Tiller I think it'd be a Bryson Tiller
here's
song
here's the setting that I'm thinking you're leaving like a funeral.
I was just gonna say that.
I know.
Best song ever.
But you heard on the radio.
Sexy
yeah, like that's what I'm saying.
Sexy kid.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like you, it's not universally usable. That's why
no.
I'm saying like I don't think I can pick one for my life. It's too much pressure. I think mine would be a Bryson Tiller song. I just don't know which one.
Oh, fire!
But I really like Bryson. I feel like it's multi.
Fire.
It's multi-dimensional.
Multifaceted.
You can
you
use
know,
that for a couple
any environment,
things.
Pre-game,
yeah, you can.
Car
yes.
jam, depressing.
Yes, yes.
You know, you
yes.
do need a song that's flexible and I believe that's American Pie for me.
Yeah.
So real.
I, you know, what about you? It's yours.
So
you posed the question.
I know. And here's the thing is I was
oh, now
really
she's
debating.
Getting nervous.
No,
oh,
guys.
She's starting to question
no,
her question.
No, I know my song is good.
Uh-oh.
So don't even go there. I thought, okay, what's something that I can listen to at all moods and all occasions? So it's like, I'm happy. Yeah, this is a happy song for sure. Or I'm sad. It doesn't like hype me up. It's definitely
yeah.
happy lyrics, but like, you know,
okay.
it could give you that. Wedding.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I need to hear
fits.
It.
Love on the Weekend by John Mayer. Now, here's the thing, is I see you looking at me, Kamyar. I was going with a Drake song
American
at first.
Pie's looking a lot too. Better right now.
I was going with a Drake song at okay. first. If you have not listened to Love on the Weekend by John Mayer, go turn it on after this episode, during, right now. Pause. This go is, ahead. If you're is... watching, pause. Go listen to it. It's a happy song, guys.
I don't know that song. Oh my God, wait, that's what? Not what I was expecting. Wow, that's criminal.
Wait, I like, maybe if I hear it, I'll know it.
Love on the weekend. Love on the weekend.
Okay,
like
I've
only
never
we did. Like only we did.
It's by John Mayer.
Not a big John Mayer fan, I will say that.
Oh, it's a great song.
I actually like, you know, you're like, oh, if I hear it, I'll recognize it.
I have no idea.
Just
stop this train.
And that's another great John Mayer up. Song.
Okay, so it turns out I don't know any John Mayer songs.
Yeah, you apparently. Need to listen to some because he I really
maybe
is.
Maybe we should make your really music awesome. More eclectic.
We could always use. So I just started listening to country music for the first time, like maybe
he's
a year
ago. He's not country.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, oh, like, for reference I'm of like oh, how okay. my music taste okay. is definitely like it could use some. We're opening up.
It could
you
use
know?
Some expansion.
It could use some expansion. Yeah. But I'll give it a listen after the show.
I like to hear
please.
It.
Please.
I like your openness.
Back. I'm report open. Back. I'm not like other people.
Dylan Luden other said. People. Dylan Luden in our chat group said, "Is John Mayer better than T Swift?" Yes, hands down, a million quadrillion percent. I can see
I
you like
can't,
Taylor
I can't
Swift.
Comment on this.
Me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
to say.
I do, and like I really oh appreciate her, but there's something about the Swifties that just like
grind
kind of like
gears.
Really annoys me.
I didn't have a Mad segment this week, but that would have been it yeah. if I knew we were talking
like,
about.
I love Taylor Swift, but the Swifties have really ruined her for me, if I'm going to be honest, because if you're not diehard Taylor Swift, you don't even like her. Do you even like her? Do you even... It's like... I really like her. Like, I enjoy listening to her music. Do I need
why?
To, like... Why? You don't like enjoying...
No.
Oh, interesting. Well, one, it's very nostalgic for me, I think. Mm. I listen to a lot of it with my siblings, and, like, I also just, like, associate with a lot of it with certain memories.
Fair.
And I also think it's, like, calming most of the time. It's not, like, anything that's gonna, like... bring anything crazy out of you, but
true.
It's a nice tune.
Very true.
And she's talented.
I can agree
so.
With that, but I think your point's valid. Like, I feel like that's the thing I have is it's either like you either like people either hate Taylor Swift or they're like diehard. There's not that many people that feel like that fall into your category where they can just be a fan like and like any other artist. Like, it feels very like aggressive.
Yeah, like
you
even
have to be
my
one
brother's
side
like
or
that.
The
I'm
other.
Like, okay, calm down.
And yeah. I'm like, can I just be in the middle?
Yeah,
can I just like her couple of her songs?
Yeah.
Like, is that okay or not okay?
I don't hate Taylor Swift's music, but then again, like, I'd...
Would I put it on
rather
every
do so many other things, like pull hair out of my head.
I just did not know that about you. I'm, like, shocked.
I actually could have seen you being a Swiftie. I don't know why.
Everyone says
same.
That. Because
I don't know why.
It's because I'm a white girl with blue
no,
eyes,
but
blonde
I'm
hair.
A white girl.
I fit the demographic.
You love pink.
Oh, the blue. You I look at my pink suit. Like, are you kidding me?
That is literally
like,
why.
Like, I fit the demographic
of a Swiftie.
You fit the demographic
way too hard.
So, I don't know. I...
Well, maybe but, just specifically
but to
today.
Be honest, I think I'd rather listen to American Pie for the rest of my life than listen Woo! To Taylor Swift ever once.
She's taking that as a complete victory.
Yeah, true.
She's taking complete that as a complete victory.
Well, speaking of victories and jumping into the sports aspect of our show.
Yeah, we got distracted.
We could talk about music for apparently. Literally the whole 40 minutes. But I want to talk about an insane victory that happened. Before we jump into... the madness that is March. Ooh. Jasmine Paris, the Barkley Marathon. We have a graphic of that on the screen.
Let me tell you, this is insane. You don't
insane.
This
you'll
marathon,
see in the graphic, but it is
so as
insane.
You can see the graphic. It's a 20-mile loop. So as you see on the right of the screen, loop 1 and 2 a day and night lap clockwise. Loop 3 and 4 a day and night lap counterclockwise. And if the runners make it to loop 5, the first one picks the direction they want to run the lap and racers will follow. Now, this loop is 20 miles long. You're in the Appalachian Mountains in Tennessee, okay?
No, the Tennessee backcountry. This is the woods.
Yeah.
These are not paths.
Yeah.
I did not realize.
No, it's not.
It's
like,
hiking. It's not like a run. They're literally going through bushes, like through brambles. Yes. This is not for the fair-hearted. Like, this is insane.
It's actually really interesting because I read a book about this. It's like ultra-marathoning, but like.
I didn't even know this existed
like
until today.
Crazy climates, and she's obviously the first one to do this race, but I read a book about another woman, and it's just like crazy what these people their bodies through, and that they're fine. They'll go run 50 miles the next week.
Yeah. Well, let me dive into a little bit about the actual thing. Obviously, we talked about the loops and how one loop is 20 miles. This race is 100 miles with 120,000 feet of elevation. There are zero route markers. So like you were saying, Keely, this is the backcountry. And you have 60 hours to finish it in cold and wintry conditions in Tennessee. 16 people in history have done this, and now 17 with Jasmine Paris. And she is the first woman to complete this. She had 99 seconds left before the time ran out.
Which is wild.
Can you imagine? Insane. You're like 3 seconds over.
I would
60 hours.
Actually,
that's also like a think about how 99 seconds compares to 60 hours. Like that is literally like nothing in the span of that time.
That's like
minute,
that mine's will
it's
be 3
a little
seconds.
Over a minute
that
mine's
will
half.
Be 3 seconds.
We could talk about God knows what in a minute and a half. You can't even run to Allison Felix Field in a minute and a half, which is across
like,
the way.
Imagine being at that finish line and just being like,
well, the video of her finishing
is
like insane. Like she literally like collapses.
She like collapses.
Yeah, I mean, as you would imagine after running for 60 hours straight through the backcountry of Tennessee.
Literally.
But she's the first woman, which I think makes, obviously, is like why it's even bigger deal, is all the other people to have done this Barclays Marathon before were all men. She's the first woman to complete the race in 60 hours.
It's
I just
insane.
I can't imagine running through the night. Like, it's pitch black and you're running through
with
spiders.
With no route markers.
So you do,
know.
Like, this animals. This book also taught me that, like, you do try and fall asleep for a couple hours.
You do?
Yes.
Oh, you can't physically
I was gonna
do
say,
that.
Okay, yeah, I was going to say, I was like, how are they
but
still
she,
running?
She, like, said, because you're not actually sleeping, because your body, you'd been running for so long that your body's just, like, so... like hyper and like
you're just
confused.
Like laying.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was, you guys should really read this book. I had to read it for class, but it was honestly super interesting and insightful. And hearing about someone's mindset when they run like
that's
50 miles for fun.
I couldn't.
That's mental toughness.
I couldn't.
That is peak mental toughness.
Well, this kind of sparked a question in my head. Like seeing this is one of the most insane athletic feats that I've seen in a long time. And was truly just in awe of this because
insane.
This takes an insane type of person to do this, first of all. But B, like to be the first woman to do this out of only 17 people in history that have done this already, like that is remarkable to me. So this poses a question for you guys. What is an insane athletic moment that had you guys just like, wow? Whether it was recently or just in your lifetime, where you're like, dang, I can't believe that happened.
I mean, I think for me, like when I think of growing up, obviously I have a lot of soccer players that come to mind, but I think the one that sticks out to me as like all-time great is Serena Williams. I mean, I just think like with what she has done with 23 Grand Slams, more than any man or woman in the Open era, 3 gold medals, 14 doubles titles. And I just like, for me, like what she represents, the way she carries herself, the way she's stood up for what she believes in, for women in sports, and just like how much of a badass she is overall. Like, I just remember being like, that woman, like that's like, if God were an athlete, that's who it would be.
I mean, you're
like,
right.
Like that's what, so like growing up, I remember, and like, she was still playing into like my adulthood, like basically. And still winning. So it's like, to me, as a mom, like, I feel like she's done so many things at such a high level. And like, she's so well respected in not just tennis, but like in sports. Like, to me, that's probably the one that will stand out to me. Like,
totally. I mean, I feel like we've lived in such a crazy era of women's athletics. Like, we've seen so many women merge into literally the greatest of all time, which is probably the coolest thing. Like, even mm-hmm. on our own campus, we have Allison Felix Field, one of yeah. the best track runners in awesome. USA history. Like, that's dope. And to, like, have yeah. those women. And I think going off of, like, that individual sport, mine would have to be Simone Biles. I mean, I was a Gabby Douglas girl yeah. until Simone came into the picture.
So good.
But now she's a Chicago girl, too, so gotta, like, show her some love.
Any chance Hayes gets yeah. to talk about Chicago, actually, she's gonna take it.
But Simone Biles has the most world all-around titles at 6. Like, the girl is just insane.
She has her own move named after her.
Yes, like, and she just, like, was so poised. And I think also her, the way she handled her health in Tokyo was, yeah. a lot of people saw it as weak, but it was one of the strongest things an Olympian can do, was step back from the thing they have literally waited, it was 5 years at that time, to mm-hmm. do. Yeah. And I just have so much respect for her, and she's pushed the sport so far along, and I think that that's someone who I'm just like, wow, they deserve the space they have, they deserve the records they hold, and, like, I want to see you again on that podium, and I want to see you flipping in the air, because I could never do that. I can't even touch my toes, so.
Like, literally, no, could actually never. Yeah, I mean, I think, like, of even just the current state of women's basketball, like, which this is actually a great segue because we'll jump right into it. But I just think of our own, like, Juju Watkins as a freshman, just breaking the freshman scoring record. Like, what? And then you have Caitlin Clark awesome. In the same season that broke the NCAA scoring record. The fact
All time,
like, people. Get that right.
It's wild to me. And she did it in 4. So there's no asterisk, like, yeah. oh, she got the COVID year, yeah. blah, blah, blah.
I love that. I love that.
Which is so cool. But this segues right into the lovely Sweet 16 that starts on Friday.
Woohoo! Yeah.
We have so many great matchups. Like, these are,
it's so good.
All of these teams are just incredible now. So let's start with Albany 1, because I want to get your picks for who you guys have for the Elite 8. First game in Albany Region 1, you have South Carolina versus Indiana.
Oh, hands down, South Carolina will win that game.
I'm with you on that.
They've yeah. been in that position before. Mm-hmm. I have no doubt that they'll come out with the W.
I forget how many games they've played recently, but they are on a, like, they've won 72, I think.
Yeah, I think
they're
so.
Like 72-1 yeah. in the past, like, 2 years.
Yeah. No, that I just saw that stat,
like, a championship game.
Yeah.
It's like the game they lost last year.
It's insane. So, like, yeah. in the past 2 years, they've literally yeah. lost one game.
They look good.
It's insane. Great and leadership. I don't think they're going to lose in this regional. So I think they're going to win that one. Next, you have Oregon State versus Notre Dame.
Okay, we agreed on this.
Mm-hmm.
And we took, I think Oregon State could really upset Notre Dame. These girls are nasty, one. They play with a lot of grit.
They do.
Which I think is good and bad.
They're chippy.
Question mark.
They're chippy.
Question mark.
Fair to say.
But I don't know. I see Notre Dame just being knocked off early yet.
I hope so, because, I mean, the Fighting Irish, goodbye. Like, I mean, as a USC fan my whole life, I can't do it. Okay, Chicago, you go to USC. Like, come on. That's one of our biggest rivals here.
Did you guys not know that?
No.
I assumed that. Yeah, it made sense.
I know.
But I don't know. I think it's 5 Pac-12 schools in this tournament still? Is that what it is?
5. UCLA, USC, Oregon State. Mm-hmm.
Colorado, Stanford.
Yep.
Wow. I think
that is an insane stat. I just want to point that
yeah,
out.
Like, yeah. I think the Pac-12 has some bite right now. And I think it's because of the last season.
They have a lot to fight for.
This is an inevitable thing that's happening literally the second they're done with this tournament, that the conference they play for is not going to exist anymore. So I think that deep down inside, there's this, like, fight and this urge, especially Oregon State, who doesn't have a conference
right
now. I was
going to say, this matters a lot to them.
It does.
Because they got left behind, arguably.
And they also, women's basketball is not going to shape where they go.
That's what I was going
to
say.
And which conference they go to, but they want to fight for it.
It's kind of an FU.
They want
to
dive. Yeah, they're going to dig down deep. I think Oregon State's taking that one.
I'm going to have to go Oregon State, too, because I want them to win. even though I think obviously like I think people obviously have them not expected to win. I want them to, and I feel like they have a good opportunity. So
yeah, if that's the upset that's gonna happen, I'm down with it.
Yeah, happy with that one.
Yeah, well, let's jump to the other side of the bracket with Albany Region 2. They're Iowa versus Colorado.
Iowa. Yeah, I mean, Colorado's good, but like,
how can you go?
But I just feel like, yeah, how do you go against Iowa?
Yeah, I think that one is a nationwide pick.
Yeah, I don't think
there.
Anyone's like,
yeah,
going against that.
Yeah, and then down on the other side of Albany Region 2 is LSU and UCLA. This is a 2-3.
I think that'll be a really good game.
I am ready for that to be. That's gonna be so chippy.
Yeah,
yeah, it's gonna be chippy.
To be honest, I think that could be one of the best games of the Sweet 16.
Like, but then that next game could be that rematch, Iowa-LSU, which will only be the quarterfinal, which is insane.
Which is insane.
Yeah. I think that's going to be a good game for sure. I mean, as a USC fan, I don't want to root for UCLA. I think they have a good chance.
Yeah.
But I'm going to go with LSU. I think, but then again, they have a lot going on internally right now that I think could make them combust.
I have a feeling they'll be knocked out if they play Iowa. Like,
but do you think
there's a lot of tension on that team?
But do you think UCLA has the? Do you think UCLA has the power to do that?
That I genuinely don't know.
I feel like UCLA is also like they've had a little bit of unpredictability throughout the season, so I think it just depends how they show up and play.
Yeah,
you know, it's gonna depend, and like you said, for LSU, it's gonna depend on like how bad are things in the locker room right now. Like we don't really know with what's going on with Coach Mulkey, and you see Van Leek like, is kind of sitting out a little bit.
Just,
it seems like there's some tension.
I wonder what is going on in there.
I wish I was a fly on the wall in that room. Literally. I think there's definitely some stuff that's gonna come out after the season. I wouldn't be surprised.
We'll touch on that drama later. But yeah. I have LSU final pick. I know it's a toss up, but.
I'm going to take LSU. I just think they're too, like, one, mentally tough. They've been in this position before. But two, like, physically, they're just, like, I mean, that UCLA team's pretty big. But just, like, they're gritty.
Yeah.
I'm going to go LSU.
Keely?
Yeah, I'm going to go LSU as well.
I'm glad the Trojans didn't pick UCLA. Now, jumping down back to the other side of the bracket, Portland Region 4. We have Texas versus Gonzaga. We all know what I'm going to pick, so I'm going to let you guys talk first.
I honestly don't know much about these two teams, if I'm going to be
fine.
Honest, but
I honestly,
I'm sorry, but I'm leaning Gonzaga.
You have a one versus a four.
Texas is the one.
Texas is the one.
Wait, that's crazy that both your teams.
I don't know why, but like I just like feel like
I feel like I
knew nothing about Gonzaga. Like,
I'm going to be honest.
What do you say?
I feel an upset coming.
Okay.
I just feel like I know a little bit of I feel like I followed Tex a little bit, but I feel like I didn't even know Gonzaga was good on the women's side. That sounds so bad. I know their men's team. Like
the
I know more
school.
About
it's a basketball school.
It's a basketball school, but I just didn't realize the women's side was this good. I mean, fourth is not a bad seeding, but you're coming out of the WCC, which is so weak, especially on the women's side. I feel like I kind of have an insight to that because I played at WCC school, and I just feel like. I don't know. I wouldn't say women's hoops is like a top thing there. So I feel like I'm going to have to stick with Texas.
Let's go. I'm going to go with Texas, obviously. I have them winning the whole thing, to be honest, against USC in the national championship.
Okay, but can we say a minute? You have them winning? Like, but you go here now.
I do. I know, but I played for them. Come on.
Loyalty should lie with the Longhorns.
My loyalty. I spent 4 years there.
That's fair.
I just had to pose the question.
Yeah. I had to pose the question. No, that's so
it's
that's
a fair
so
question.
Valid, especially because you played there. I feel like that makes a huge difference.
Yeah,
that's
and
huge
I'm
difference.
Hoping to go back there, but that's besides the point.
We love Austin.
I think they have an insane freshman. Our star player, I say our because, I mean, come on.
These are girls.
Our star player, her name's Rory Harmon. She tore her ACL like mid-season. And Madison Booker, this freshman, stepped up.
Oh, yeah.
Like, really stepped up. KD is like predicting that number 35 will be retired on the women's side. She's a freshman.
Yes. Freshman?
I didn't realize she was a freshman.
A true freshman.
I've heard her name before, but I didn't like put that together.
You know? A true freshman. Baller. And she is killing it. Like, truly killing it. And there are some other, like, insane, like, girls on that team.
Have you been really keeping up with that team?
I I mean, I keep up with all Texas athletics. I think it's just like in my blood now to need to know how the whole how the whole school's doing. But I mean, I've been watching a couple. I think I've watched two of their games, I believe. And they just look good. Like, they won the Big 12, so they're coming off of that high also.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the Sweet 16 now, but we have Shaylee Gonzalez, who's a graduate student, and she is just, like, actually killing it, too. Like, they're just, there's so much star power on this team that it's really, it's a full team thing. It's not just Madison Booker. It's not just Shaylee Gonzalez. And even, like, you look at USC, how there's Juju Watkins, Mackenzie Forbes, Raya Marshall, like, there are so many people
on that
team.
That's how I feel about USC, where it's like they're probably the spazziest team I've ever seen play.
She's loving that.
I'm sure. Truly. I'm sure Texas is not as like. It's
I haven't watched enough games to test the waters, but I don't know.
I do give so much credit to teams that just like have built an overall. Like, you can have the star, but like if you build.
Around,
build, like,
you're saying, like, have, like, a strong foundation where, like, it's the team, yeah, it's like, collectively.
Well, it's just basically, like if
Forbes
you're...
has transferred, like, a bunch of times.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, yeah. having her come here was probably, like, she could have just been, like, F it, I'm just gonna mess around here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love that, well, here's the thing, it's, like, you need to build a team that if your star player gets hurt, you can still compete. And I think that's something that Texas has done and something that USC has done, which we'll jump to that side in a second. But I have Texas beating Gonzaga. You have Gonzaga?
It's like, hard in women's, honestly. I'll take Texas. It's hard in women's also because women don't usually upset.
No. I think,
very,
I think in last year's championship, it was all 4-1 seeds in the semifinal. I literally think
No, I think you're right. That's right, Muff.
Hey, yeah. It's better to bet on. It's a safer bet.
It is maybe, a safer bet.
Maybe the bracketology really works out on the
Yeah,
side.
They just got it lined up perfect.
They probably just, don't give away $1 million or so for a perfect bracket on the women's side.
True.
That's
true.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Well, jumping down to that last game in the Portland region four, you have NC State versus Stanford.
Feel like this could be closer.
A two versus a three.
NC State bed looking very gritty. Like, I don't know. They got some,
I don't know if Stanford's ready for
that. They got an edge
that.
To them. And, like, Cameron Brink just, like, she's meh for me right now.
Well, she almost fouled out of the Iowa State game.
Yeah, I've not she been did. Impressed with her. She's kind of been, like, Miss Pouty. Like, come on.
Well, they went to overtime with Iowa State, and they only ended up winning 87-81. That's a close game for overtime.
She was
too.
Getting into it with
that big
Audie Crooks.
Audie Crooks.
Well, here's
I will say Iowa State obviously is good though. For where they're seated, like, that is a tough matchup to have in the second round. Like, they're a 7 seed, but I think they're, like you said,
but, like,
they're
think
tough.
Stanford's like banged up from that.
That's what I'm saying. I feel like they might be kind of banged up. Like, I don't know if they'll be ready for this NC State team.
Yeah, here's my prediction. I watched that Stanford-Iowa State game, part of it.
Yeah.
And I don't think that Stanford winning that game gave them, like, the, heck yeah, we did it, but we need to pick it up because we almost lost.
Yeah, no.
Like, we need to grind the rest of the tournament, blah, blah, blah. I think it was more of a, phew, we got past them, like, we almost did it. Mm. Like, oh gosh. And I think it was kind of like a oh no type moment rather than like a we need to get our crap together.
Yeah.
So I don't think they're going to go into this NC State game with as much bite as they need to. Now, that's completely an outsider's opinion. Obviously, I'm not in the locker room. But I think from an outsider perspective, that's kind of what it seemed like from just watching the body language of that Stanford team after the Iowa State game. So I'm taking NC State.
I love your analysis.
Thank you.
Yeah, good analysis
today.
Thank
you.
Yeah, I'll take NC State.
Yeah. I mean, I am from the Bay, so I feel... No, I think I'm going to go same.
Take your rival.
Isn't that your rival?
Yeah. But I mean, like...
When you're making picks, that's not really something.
Yeah, I feel like I feel like I can't let that influence my
picks.
That's influencing her decision.
To be honest, like, I could never pick UCLA winning anything. I had UCLA, Texas A&M, and Oklahoma losing in the first round of every single bracket that I ever made.
Yeah.
Girl, oh, you'd be really bad at betting.
There's no logic in this. There's literally no logic, especially the men's side. Upsets happen all the freaking time. Okay, Mr. Bracketology, who doesn't believe in anything back there. There's literally no science, no logic, no anything that goes into any of this stuff. It's sports. That's why we love it. There are upsets all the time, especially on the men's side, because you have these guys leaving after their freshman year who play like one season and are done. Like, you don't have these senior stars like you do on the women's side.
No, you're right.
So you have these men who have a fresh team, especially with the transfer portal being so big now, who have not played together very often other than one season. So it's like, okay, literally anything can happen. Where the women's side, you see these girls playing together for up to 4 years. Caitlin Clark has been at Iowa for 4 years. Angel Reese has been at LSU, I think, for three. Is she a senior? I think
she's a junior.
A junior, right?
She's a junior.
For three. I mean, you see Haley transferring to LSU, was for a grad transfer, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. They play longer on the women's side.
You play longer. Yeah. Your loyalty is longer on the women's side.
Which it also kind of has to be. You're not going to...
I mean, NIL money does not affect you as a women's basketball player.
No, but it also, like, you're not going to go to the WNBA after freshman year, where, like, the NBA you are.
That's kind of a common, more common.
So, I think there's also,
that's
like...
a rule change that should happen.
I think that's also a great narrative of why, like, women's basketball should have probably been more viewed and more popular sooner. Like, there's better storylines. Mm-hmm. Like, you're watching these girls who have grown up with their teammates for 4 years and... have and these coaches that are so committed, and they're not.
There's a lot more buy-in. There's a lot more buy-in. Like, on the men's side, the turnover is a lot. It's a lot of transfer. Even before the transfer portal blew up with COVID, guys in basketball, I think that was like the number one sport to see transfers in basketball and football. But you would see guys leaving, moving around all the time. Like, I feel like you don't see that as much on the women's side. So, like, you're seeing girls that, like, they put a lot into this, and, like, teams that I've been playing together, like, the teamwork is there, like, the coordination, all that's there. Like, the men's side is like you said, you see freshmen, it's like they just got there and they're just like, kind of, everyone's kind of playing their own game, but, like, there's some star power.
Well, like,
so you're
it
like,
just
it's
shows
exciting.
Kentucky. Like, you just stick a bunch of freshmen together and just expect them to make
Dillingham,
magic.
Freshman of the year.
That's funny.
Wait, Connor
actually
said,
question though. Oh wait,
yeah,
no,
go,
can.
Go.
Did either of you take you guys didn't take 5th years, or you did here?
Yeah, I did.
But, I did at Texas.
Oh, you did.
Yeah.
Okay. And how much? What percentage of your team did? Most
oh gosh, of my
many.
Class,
I just wonder that in terms of women's basketball, I'm sure that's common.
5 of the 8 of us,
so more
or
than four, half.
1, 2, 3, 5 of the 8 of us in my class took our 5th years at Texas.
Wow,
I know, which I should have left, but that's another story.
Yeah, of my class, I think there was 4 girls that did of my class, but the year above it was like everybody.
Yeah,
because
like that was COVID.
Girls,
that COVID
that was the
year,
COVID.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's pretty big number. A lot of girls on my team came back for 6 years, which is crazy.
Yeah, one girl on mine.
6 years. Yeah.
Yeah, one girl on mine.
I've
did
played
that.
With multiple girls who are like 24 and older. Sometimes
that's
like
crazy.
That's so like the,
well, all those COVID years are phasing out now.
Now that you're not gonna see that anymore.
Yeah, literally.
No, I remember my freshman year
unless
though. Before
you
redshirt. No, before before COVID thing. My freshman year on my team, we had like a 25-year-old, and she was so scary. She had a full arm sleeve. And I was so scared of her.
Woman
and she was a grown woman.
Old.
I was really 18.
You're like, what's your
and
goal?
And I was like, I'm
you're
scared
25.
Of you.
What is your goal?
That's
like, what was her goal?
I don't know.
Older.
To make my life horrible.
No,
she yelled at me
like,
every game, and I was like, you're so scary. You're so scary.
But she's 25. Like, what does she want to do? Why is she still in college?
Well, I think she wanted
to
be the team manager, but she didn't end up becoming the team manager. So sad for her.
It's because she was yelling at Keely on the field.
Sad for her.
I don't know, because after that, I literally told the coach, I'm leaving because she bullied me. And he was like, well, she's gone. I was like, I don't care. I'm still leaving. I also don't like
PTSD
the school that much.
But you didn't leave.
My first year,
San Francisco.
San Francisco? Yeah, I was only there for a semester. I said, bye.
Wait, this is at San Francisco?
Yes.
That's correct.
She was, no, she
I thought
was,
you were talking about Berkeley.
No, not at Berkeley. No, we did not have anybody that old on
I
team.
I was
going to
say that's allowed.
Yeah, that's wild.
It is allowed, though. But, like, somehow people sometimes get, like, 7th years. I'm like, how do they get
no,
that?
I
no, that organ.
I was
that
eligible.
Organ, wait, how? Did you redshirt?
Can you explain to me some of the details?
Okay, guys. So I
need to know this.
Well, I was like brutally injured, but my freshman and sophomore year. So I have a red shirt and a gray shirt, which is a medical red shirt, and then COVID year. So that's seven.
Okay, but this is what I don't understand. I get why people can, because it's not
I'm like, no, but it's Angela Kelly.
No, this is what I don't
know. Never want to see you.
No, again. That makes sense. Like, I get you're saying, because if you have two injuries, which is in soccer, it's actually not that uncommon to miss gray two seasons. Shirt. It's not that uncommon.
Isn't that funny?
But then, and you have the COVID year. But like, the NCAA rule says 6 years max to complete four. So how do people get seventh?
Because of COVID.
So COVID, like, six to complete four. But like, does COVID like span beyond that rule? So now you can have seven?
Well, now.
No. You can have nine.
Schools are making a master's program that's only 1 year. That's a thing that's happening now.
I'm just saying, if they said you only have 6 years, like
to
your
complete,
time.
No.
Your undergrad.
You're undergrad.
Four. Oh, so grad school, it resets?
Yeah. No, like you don't get like
another
extra,
six.
You don't get like an extra 4 years.
But you get
like,
extra years?
You get extra years.
Yeah. See, I don't know where that is in the fine print, but that's crazy.
Because do you guys remember that guy from Oregon? Like, people are now setting records for how long they've been in college. But
yeah.
I know there's a football player at Oregon. About. You know him?
The punter.
No, I know who you're talking about, though.
Right?
He like got injured. No, I don't think it's a punter. I think it's a receiver.
Yeah,
he's not
good.
He's not relevant.
I think it's a receiver.
But
yeah.
And then he like got his COVID year, and then he redshirted.
He was like
first.
An eighth year or something.
No,
right?
he has nine.
Oregon's Cam McCormick, a ninth year of eligibility.
Yeah,
I call it.
Oregon tight end. Oregon tight end.
I'm usually not right about this.
Cam McCormick, who was a freshman. Guys, listen to this. A freshman in 2016. I was a junior in high school.
I was in eighth grade.
Did he just? Is he just graduating this year?
No,
he has one more.
To go for a 10?
To return.
For nine.
This is to return in 2023, which I think he did.
Yeah,
he did.
To return again to Eugene in 2023. I've thought about it. It's a tough decision. I'm not totally keen on what my decision is going to be
yet.
I'm going to continue to enjoy this game with my teammates and make the decision after the game.
Imagine having a 28-year-old teammate.
Did the NCAA see this coming?
I mean, he literally said, I tore my Achilles when I applied to Ohio State. So, like, the man has been through it. He suffered four straight season-ending injuries from 2018 to 2021. And he was also one of three to be hospitalized for, rhabdomyolysis.
What is that?
What the heck? Following an overly intense workout. Oh my gosh. Oregon players hospitalized after intense workout. This military-style training caused some players to pass out and prompted a statement from the school. He was literally hospitalized for this. First of all, we had to do that stuff. Okay, wait. The players were put... the players were put...
This is why Madison's like, oh,
no,
what
guys.
A wimp.
We had to do Navy SEAL training. We had literal Navy SEALs come in for 4 days and take us through training.
That sounds lit.
I'm like,
We tried to do that SC, I kid you not.
We had to fight
Girls would have literally gotten up and walked out. And I mean that. I could think of five girls right now who I would have seen them walk in, would have stood up, not said a word, and just hit the door. And our coach wouldn't have said anything. She would have watched them go and been like, understandable. And the rest of us would have done the workout.
Yeah.
While they were gone.
This is so interesting.
College athletics is crazy. What can I say? It's just a wild world out there.
This rhabdomyolysis.
Break down the science for us, Madison.
Can happen when the intensity of a workout spikes and athletes overexert themselves. It can cause the body's muscles to break down to such an extent that their cells flood in the bloodstream and can lead to kidney failure.
What? So what I'm hearing is he's a China doll.
Yeah. I guess for him
I did that, and I didn't get rhabdomyolysis. Like, it's sad. At that point, you got your Achilles. You probably had an ACL.
Oh,
Okay, well, we went on a tangent. We have 30 seconds. You have USC and Baylor. Who are you taking?
USC, go!
USC, fight on, fight on, fight on.
UConn or Duke?
UConn.
Paige Bueckers.
I want to see that UConn-USC matchup.
Yeah, but me then too. Who do you have for that? I don't even want to. I'm getting stressed already of thinking
USC,
about it.
Baby. USC, but I'm take down this, the Paige Bueckers supremacy.
I want it to go.
That is all the time that we have with the girl gang. Make sure you stay tuned because we have some baseball talk coming up next. So keep watching for some more exciting stuff before MLB opening day.
Woo.
And welcome back to the Talk of Troy. Packed house here, full house.
Full house.
We're going to talk some baseball.
I'm only here because Chris made me.
That's right.
John Stamos.
That means we are going to have some banter, some shots fired. When Kamir's in the building, you don't know where it's going to go, right? But the objective today is to talk some ball, guys, because tomorrow, opening day for the other 28 teams.
It's a national holiday.
Yeah.
So excited.
Anyone going to games?
No.
No.
What do you think, Chris? We live in Los Angeles, and the Dodgers tickets are $100.
We gotta pay him somehow, bro.
I can wait 2 weeks, and it'll drop down in half.
Yeah, once Ohtani gets suspended.
All right, buddy. All right.
Well, speaking of, on the topic, obviously Shohei Ohtani had a press conference on Monday where he addressed the media for the first time, but he did not answer any questions. I mean, all he kind of said was he gave a little gray area about the situation. He said that he has never bet before. He has never sent money to a bookkeeper. And that his interpreter, iPay, was telling lies this entire time and that he committed theft.
He threw his friend under the bus.
So I think it's pretty ironic. I mean, Dylan and I talked about it this morning, but Shohei has come out now. And this is like this is a different story than what was initially came out with the initial report. That iPay, you know, he went on ESPN and in an interview said that, you know, Shohei Ohtani lent him money and that it was a knowingly and a willingly thing that he did. And it was kind of presumed that amongst both parties that that was the story. And then Shohei said something completely different this afternoon. So obviously the biggest topic of conversation, but is he going to sit on a bench at all this season? What do you guys think?
I mean, you got to think about who has more to lose in this situation. And obviously that's Shohei because he's Shohei Ohtani. And so I think if anyone were to lie, it would be Shohei Ohtani because the interpreter could probably tell the truth, get like less of a, you know, consequence because he's more or less a normal guy and not a huge star. So I think at the end of the day, I'm going to probably believe him over Shohei because Shohei has so much to lose at this point.
That's not a good argument, bro, because the lawyers, Shohei Ohtani's lawyers are the ones who even unraveled this in the first place. So why would his lawyers rat on their own client? That's not even plausible.
Because you're going to have to say something. Like, man.
Let Kamir speak. I want to hear. Kamir is probably like, I want to hear his opinion because this man is.
Wait. So if.
Let's hear this.
you're telling me, okay, wait, does that mean if he's actually, if this interpreter is actually going to be the fall guy, like, there's got to be some offshore account somewhere wiring a bunch of money to his account, right? Like, there's no reason. Like,
it was in Shohei's name.
Bro, but what I'm telling you is, like, there's no... No, what? I just said, bro, just because you know ball and could go down a baseball roster.
You see this guy?
And it... Nah.
No, go on, go on.
But what I'm saying is, like, just because... If I'm going to be the fall person, I'm not doing this out of the kind... Like, I'm not being framed out of the kindness of my heart just because Shohei's my guy.
Okay, but if someone's going to take the fall, you know, why not...
I'm getting compensated.
Maybe he is, and we don't know.
So literally, you ignored my initial question and said I didn't, and, you know, just rambled on a little bit. I literally said, like, there's got to be, like, some sneaky little offshore accounts that has to be, like... Like, there is going to be some money traced back to this interpreter if, quote-unquote, he is the fall person, no?
No, yeah, I absolutely. Yeah. I mean, he's came out and said publicly that he has a gambling addiction, and that he, at his end of the story goes that he borrowed money from Ohtani, and that it was something that Ohtani knew about, and Ohtani willingly sent it to him. And obviously, Ohtani addressed the media and, you know, had other things to say, but it is evident that he has a crippling gambling addiction, and that
this
has been ongoing for a good
Logan,
amount of time.
That's if what they want you to believe is true.
No, okay, I mean, $4.5 million is how much this guy is in debt. That's something that doesn't accumulate over 2 months, 6 months. That's over a long period of time. $4.5 million. That's how much money this guy was in debt.
All right, let me speak real quick, because initially, right, the first story came out. The first story was that Shohei learned of it, and he paid, you know, he helped pay off his debt, right, to the bookie, who is probably 20 minutes from my house.
That's frightening.
Flex.
It is frightening, right? This dude's house got raided by the FBI in San Juan Capistrano.
I don't like that. I don't like anyways, that at all.
And then the second story came out where Ohtani never knew about this, and Ipe apparently lied to ESPN. And, you know, it came out that he actually lied about where he got his college degree from. He never graduated from UC Riverside. Out of all places, you lie about your education? Kinda,
yeah,
no way!
I'm sorry. I had to throw that out there. But
that was a low blow.
I'm sorry. But like,
about my Highlanders?
Well, like, come on.
Come on, man. Riverside ties. What do you know about it?
I know. But anyways, but he made these accusations that that Ipe is a liar and a thief. Straight up said this. Man's a liar teasing. And a thief. If you're coming at a guy like that, where you're saying he's a straight up liar and a thief, and he has these, you know, you're going through this whole allegation process, and you're talking to the authorities, you're cooperating with them, you're filing a complaint, and then he also stated that they are talking to authorities he didn't specify what authorities, but when you have this sort of language going on, it's real serious. And that means if Ohtani's lying about this, he could face even more punishment if he's lying about
okay,
this.
Yeah. He might be telling the truth, but he still did wire the money, which is...
But how did you know? It could be as an account, or it could have been him himself. Because
Shohei Ohtani doesn't manage his own accounts. There's no millionaire on the planet that does it.
He might have approved it.
But that's the thing.
He's saying he did not have knowledge of... I pay wiring the transfer, so that's the whole point. Is that the wire transfer comes from Shohei Ohtani's bank account?
How does his interpreter have access to his bank?
Because he's been best friends with him for 11 years.
Translators serve as like especially for him. He doesn't know the culture here, so
thank
I mean, yeah.
But think I'm about, sure. but think about when you're coming over here, right? Like, imagine you're in his shoes. You're going to Japan to go play baseball, and you're bringing along your interpreter, who is going to be your friend for a long time, like they've been friends for over a decade, and you need to go to the bank and you need them to translate stuff for you. You're gonna have to give them the info, at least partially some of the info, to translate it and then put it in the bank.
No, yeah,
I don't get how people don't think about that.
No,
because that's what happened when Ohtani came over here.
I see
here.
Your point, but this is like a $700 million man. Like, he should be having top-notch.
Well, he's now he is now a $700 million man. He doesn't have that $700 million yet. All of his money is essentially from endorsements.
Okay, it was more like a title, but like, I don't I feel like it's kind of weird that he would have an interpreter manage all of his finances.
Well, it was probably that at the beginning, and he never changed it.
But bro, imagine you get plopped into a
I'm hiring someone who knows bank, not someone who knows just.
But if they don't know English, then that's probably going to be a bit of an issue because you could get the best financial advisor in all of Sierra Leone. But guess what? You're not going to know a lick of what anyone's telling you.
They speak French.
I think people are forgetting.
We don't know French.
People are forgetting. He knows English now.
Yeah, but he's not fluent. He doesn't know it fully.
Press conference. He didn't. Even though Ipe was just fired, he still had to have another translator and interpreter there.
I've seen interviews of him speaking English for a bit.
Dog, do you know what I mean?
It's like any player nowadays. Like, you see, like, Francisco Alvarez or, like, Elia De La Cruz, for example,
he
today.
Just came out, yeah,
did a press
exactly.
conference in all English. That doesn't mean that he, like, understands
Yes.
it.
I mean, he's been in the league longer.
But you have to also realize, like, okay, here's a perfect example. I can consider myself, like, pretty conversationally fluent in Farsi. Anything that when you have to go to... When you start bringing up politics and technical terms and the bank and money and like wire transferring, bro, there's some vocabulary that just I am not aware of. Like there's some vocabulary that I just have never heard of in my life. That takes a different level of understanding of like a mastery of language that like just because I can answer questions of, yeah, we played great, a lot of effort. Good bat right. swings. Like
rah,
like
rah, the creative sense.
So do you guys think he's guilty? That's what I'm trying to
100%.
Of guilty. Wait, hang on. Guilty,
I think
guilty,
just defending him.
No,
guilty
I wasn't.
What?
No,
what,
I wasn't
what is
because,
he? Is he guilty of placing bets or is he guilty of wire transfer?
I think
that's a whole different conversation.
I think this entire scenario, because everything that you mentioned about his translator, I think you're telling me you don't think this is all a little too convenient as like the perfect.
Yes. That's what I've been saying the whole time.
Yeah, but you're also make some horrible points. So
no,
like,
that's not true.
You also like.
Wait, keep going about conveniency. Why is it
conveniency? Because like, oh. As of like what a couple weeks ago or a week ago now, it's he also faked his college degree. Oh, he also just happens to be 4 million in debt.
He
just also
need for him to know he's a compulsive liar.
That's
a point. Like, I don't doubt he's a liar, but it really comes down to even if Shohei didn't know what he was doing was wrong. At the end of the day, wiring money to do or lending money in that context is still illegal. I'm not saying Shohei's a bad person.
But are
that.
You? But you're thinking he's the one that wired it, and not Ipe stealing it from.
I didn't say that. I said, it's in his name.
The only reason we're talking about this is because it's in his name. Correct. Because the investigation that like whatever
it's in
LA
the bookie.
Running,
it's in the bookie. Yes.
That's why
it goes back to him. But the bigger one.
Here, let's ask the question: would you rather trust the guy that eats, sleeps, breathes baseball so much that he has a pillow conformed to his head and neck to maximize his every amount of sleep? Go look on GQ.
Please.
Go look on GQ's top 10 everything
I've heard
you
it
need
all
in the
before.
Video. Or would you rather trust a man that lied about getting an education
again,
from UC Riverside?
No, again, like I just said, it's not about trusting. Maybe Shohei didn't know it was wrong, but at the end of the day, it's still against the rules. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm not saying
no.
Like,
yeah, true. But I mean, okay. So you're believing that he's the one that made the wire transfer?
Again, I didn't say that, but. It could be, and there's a very.
But you're
good
saying
chance.
He's lying.
Shohei?
Yes.
How? What did I say? He lied.
Didn't he just say he lied?
I think it's just masked by under Giants propaganda.
Didn't he just say he lied? Am I?
I didn't say he lied. I said there's a very good
chance.
He
knew about it.
Well, I mean, he could be lying. I'm not. That's not out of the question.
Oh, so now you don't have a stance. You're on the fence.
No, everyone's on the fence because we don't have an answer.
No, I'm not on the fence.
Oh, here we go. Here we go. He's backtracking because he knows he's wrong.
No, I'm okay. My point from the beginning. Was it was in Shohei's name, and that's against the rules, right?
But
we
no,
can all
but,
agree on that.
Yeah, but it could have not been him. It's just his account.
That's,
like
I
we
agree.
Don't know who's the one that wired it.
I'm saying that, but I agreed, but it's still in
but
his name.
But he shouldn't be suspended just because his name is on there. That's what I'm trying to say.
That's yeah, it's like fraud.
But
exactly.
It's very hard to prove that. That's what I'm saying. So
it's hard to prove that he knew about it too.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. That's what the authorities are looking into right now. One of them is the IRS. So
do you guys think like if your friend ever gets big time and then like you're like take up that like best friend manager role, like what do you think? Like, do you think you deserve like access to that account? Like, what?
Well, no.
Should we normalize getting access to your best friend's account?
No, like, I'm not translating for him. That's I feel like that's the
well,
only.
Well, your manager.
I mean, I think it's a little different because
yeah,
like Shohei, like Ipe literally said he spends more time with Shohei than he does with his wife. Like
that's true.
They're literally at like the point of like relationship
romance.
Of a friendship where it's
yeah.
literally like a bromance.
Yeah.
And they've been friends for 10 plus years at this point. That's why, like, I also don't understand how Shohei didn't know about this gambling problem, because if they've been friends for 10 years and they spend 6 hours with each other, like, every single day, how does this not just come up in conversation?
How does he not save on Prize Picks?
Like, imagine, how does this not come up in conversation?
Dude, forget sports betting. Imagine they, like, go to a casino and he's, like, he's been, like, Shohei's either fast asleep back in, I can imagine, like, some hotel room. Ibe knocks on the door drunk as I was like,
Show me the money. Shohei, I need another 200. I need another 10 grand.
This is gonna hit this time.
I'm putting it all on red 32. All right.
So Shohei with his conformed pillows just trying to cover it.
Is Shohei betting the over or the under on home runs?
On this season, I mean, I think if Shohei plays, he's gonna get drop a 60 bomb.
If he plays, I'm dropping the under. I think in terms of this whole situation going on right now and the shortstop second base situation and the injury concern to the Dodger rotation, I think they're not going to hit 105 wins. Ohtani's
95 if lucky.
No. I never said not 100. I think they can hit 100, 101, 102. I just think that this whole thing going on right now is the biggest controversy that the Dodgers have had. This is bigger than Bauer. This is bigger than Urias.
No, it's not.
Yes,
it's not
bigger
than Bauer.
It's not yet.
Respectfully.
Correct.
It's not that big.
That's why.
I don't think it distracts Ohtani whatsoever.
Wait. Why is this bigger than clocking a woman in the elevator? Like, I have no idea
Well, first of all,
I think it's bigger because
define
bigger.
In terms of just like
magnitude,
the magnitude around the public are so fixated on this Ohtani story.
It's an international player who's the face of the league.
He didn't say what was worse.
I don't know, but
he said what was bigger.
Okay, but he cares about that. His money was stolen from his best friend. I don't know how you play normally after that.
He's gonna be just fine.
I'll be honest. I don't think it takes away from his game field, but I do agree with you in saying that this is probably the biggest storyline in baseball in the past.
He's gonna be more private, I think. Now, I mean, I don't think he's gonna be addressing me. You know, not to say he did all the time regularly.
Yeah,
but
true. I mean, just think about what's going on in the past 2 weeks for him. Right. First of all, he reveals, like, him and the Dodgers reveal who his wife is. Who, like, nobody knew who he was dating anyone, and the whole time he's on the Angels.
She's like low-key famous too.
Yes. Okay. Anyways,
she's got a great
going on.
Stretch.
Yeah.
So that happened, right? Great so then stretch. you got all these people like totally. They're totally, you know, like, paying attention to you and your wife, and they're trying to figure out who your wife was before she was revealed. So there was a lot of attention there. Then he gets a bomb threat placed on him in Korea. That's another thing you got to worry about too, mentally wise. And then this comes out, like, all at the same time. Like, just imagine how much attention Ohtani's getting in terms of all those sort of aspects, you know, positive and negative.
But he already has been getting that same level of attention.
Well, correct, but
I think if anything,
he's a demigod in his country.
Yeah, he's already been getting
correct, but he's getting more attention now that he's on the Dodgers.
Shohei Ohtani is the one person that would actually be able to withstand all. This guy has literally, his entire life is baseball. There's nothing else.
That's all fair, but to be, okay, honestly, I really do see what Dylan's saying, and I watch this. If bro opens the season, let's say, like, give me a number, like 30 games in, 40 games in, like something along those lines, doesn't have typical Ohtani statistics, doesn't have typical Ohtani numbers. I know the majority of people around this desk are going to be like, dang, bro's not delivering on his contract. What are the yappers are going to say on TV? They're going to say, he's not worth all that money. The Dodgers aren't getting all that money yet, though.
I mean,
focus on semantics for 2 seconds. I'm telling you, they're going to criticize him for the way he plays. And they're going to look
as they would
any player. They're going to look past, hold on, they're going to look past the fact that he had potentially his house might have been blown up.
It's $4.5 million that was his
house. He was in Korea, dude.
What does that... So if I have a house overseas and there's a bomb threat on it...
He doesn't live in Korea.
Okay,
whatever.
Stress me out? Like, what are you talking about?
No.
What are you arguing
for? Okay, whatever. I'm arguing it's not his house, but continue.
No, it was a bomb threat on him in Korea.
On him.
It wasn't anything about his house.
Okay, he's going to die of explosives.
It's the same thing, yes. Why is that?
Like, why are you so pinpointing on, like, such minute details?
Continue. I want to see what you have to say.
But my point is, like... You're really just going to be, you're going to boil it down to simply like, he's not delivering.
That happens to a lot of players though. Like, I know it sounds like it's just happening to Ohtani. Like, a ton of players have, LeBron, even your guy, has probably faced tons of similar stuff.
There's okay, that's fine.
I don't know about your best friend stealing $4.5 million of your money.
Not
that, similar
not
stuff.
That.
I mean,
I said all this stuff together is going to come and kind of cause a little more chaos. I never said that Ohtani was going to be bad. I think he's still going to hit 40 home runs. He's not going to hit 50, and he's not going to hit 60. I think the Dodgers are going to win the NLS, but I don't think they're going to be the best team that's ever been assembled that a lot of people say they are,
bro. You know what it is?
They say that every year.
He's not even allowed to be bad. Like he could. Maybe tomorrow, what could happen? Like,
he's not going to be bad.
Think of another tragedy that could happen to Ohtani, and like it, or like a scare, or just something that will greatly like raise his cortisol levels, and you're going to still be like, I mean, $700 million.
Doesn't matter how good Ohtani is, because it's baseball. Like, it all comes down to the fact that it's baseball, and if you know the Dodgers are two injuries away from not being good, so that's how I see it.
But it's not. But
they're two injuries away from being the Angels.
I'm just talking about his performance. He doesn't have the luxury of like even being like mediocre. Like no matter what happens to him off the field, everyone's just gonna be like, as soon as he isn't Ohtani the demigod, they're gonna be like, oh, we're not worth it.
He's under a magnifying glass. If you see the articles that the LA Times is publishing, especially the columnists, and they're saying, I don't even know if I believe Ohtani. They're going back on
Ohtani.
It's
a good story.
No, but to criticize who he is as a person, no one knows. Okay, this is the one thing I will see. No one knows who Ohtani is, and I think that's very intentional.
Yeah.
He's been a very private person. He wants to be a private person.
Everyone just knows
guy. Now that there's this little scandalous element, everyone wants in on his business, but he's never going to surrender that. So it's not a good effort. Like, don't try to like get into his head or be, he's got to stand up for himself and he's got to face the music, because he's never done that.
Well, I think as from like journalist perspective, it is a good story if a guy has a scandal and then proceeds to not play good. I think that's a good story, objectively.
Correlation, but you can't draw that line.
But okay, but what is that? What does as a journalist, what did you just conclude then? Okay, a guy has scandal, doesn't play well. Huh? Like, I mean, I could have seen that coming because he has a lot on his mind. Like,
no, I'm not advocating for it. I'm just saying that's what they're gonna do because they're journalists.
You don't think that's lazy? Like, you don't even think that's some of the lowest hanging fruit, laziest journalism?
Yeah,
like,
it's low hanging fruit.
Has a lot of things on his mind. Like, okay, biggest scandal that's facing, like.
No, but they have to fill in the blanks because people have been saying, we don't exactly know who Ohtani is. So they're going to.
That's fine. That's the difference. You can investigate and report this story and continue to find details and uncover stuff.
I'm not advocating for it. I'm just saying that's going to be a big story and you can't avoid it if he doesn't play good. And he is going to play good because he's a Shohei Ohtani. I think he's still great.
I agree. I'm just saying this might affect them to begin the season. I mean, I don't think that, you know, I don't think him or the Dodgers are going to live up to the lofty expectations people
put on. He doesn't
even
pay attention to the media, probably, the mainstream media.
If he can't speak English, he's not going to be reading American newspapers, American television, whatnot.
I mean, you can read online and it translates for you.
But do you think
he's not making that effort, bro?
Don't act like athletes or any of these athletes are above not looking into the media. Like,
he's different.
Why is he different?
Because he's not from America. He's not looking into New York
Times.
They
don't have the media that we have.
Yeah, their media is a lot different.
I'm sure Tanaka was really not feeling it when the Yankees media was pressuring him, dude. I'm sure about that.
Same thing with
you. I'm sure
you,
Darvish, wasn't feeling it either.
They don't
have the stardom of Shohei Ohtani.
Yeah, but true.
That's hindsight talking. That's what Shohei panned out.
But let's be reminded about what happened when Yu Darvish was on the Dodgers and he completely sucked the bed, and then everyone was coming after him, dude. He was depressed, and then he gets a whole racial comment against him, and that was another thing. Like, I mean, come on, people that come over here, I mean, they're gonna be affected by the news somewhat when you have more attention on you. Right, and
Shohei is different. It's apples and oranges to me because Shohei is just larger than life compared to like Yu Darvish or Masahiro Tanaka. It's just different. It's not the same thing. You guys said it. He eats, sleeps, breathes baseball.
Is LeBron bigger than that?
LeBron is
because
from
LeBron,
America.
I know, but he still gets affected by the media.
No, he doesn't. He's never had a bad score.
Promise he does. Promise he does get.
He's a mark against.
On record, he's LeBron been James. Shown to say like 2011, the first year with Miami. 2010, 2011, whatever. The first year with Miami, he was documented as saying, like, I wanted the hate. I wanted to embrace being a villain. I wanted all the smoke.
He's from America.
But he wanted all of that stuff. And he literally, after the season ended, after they lost to the Mavs, he's like, I realized that wasn't me. He said, I don't play the best. Like, I don't play the best that way. I don't feel the best that way. Like, it wasn't a great season for me. Like, all that stuff. Even the larger than life characters, it will affect you one way or another.
It might affect him, but I don't think it's going to affect his on-the-field play. That's what my argument. It did. Shohei. Not LeBron. LeBron doesn't play on a field.
Bro.
Casey, yeah. Dude. Fight it out. Yeah, tomorrow, talk of Troy Formal.
I mean,
we'll get there in a second.
But anyways, I mean, yeah, you're making the point that he's not from America. But what about all these dudes that come from, you know, the Dominican or Puerto Rico? Like, I mean, look at Pedro Martinez. Look at David Ortiz. Do you think the New York media, they were ever affected by it? I'm sure they were at some point.
Again, it's different. Like, it's you're comparing nearby countries to Asia, which is a completely different continent. It's a different culture.
I mean, they still love baseball, don't they?
Bro, trying to learn English when you know Spanish is so much easier than Japanese to English. And also, they're in the league a longer time. They've like been in the MLB system. And I think Ohtani doesn't even make the effort to try to learn English. So you have that, too.
That's such a lie. He's definitely made an effort to learn English,
Chris.
Has
he ever spoken English in a press conference in public?
I've seen him do it a few times.
I can learn a sentence in Japanese right now.
As an Angels fan, I've watched him speak English as an Angels fan, and I've seen him in, you know, social media videos and after game videos.
Yeah, but like, those are stuff where he has a script.
Bro,
like, or they're like 10 seconds very after, easily read off of a script.
No, I'm saying like spur of the moment, like after a game, he'll speak some English. Like
because we'll ask him, hey, great home run. How did that feel? That is the most generic answer.
Good.
Great. Like, I feel like anyone at that point is able to. I just don't understand, like, this.
I don't know. I mean, look at Messi. People thought Messi didn't speak English, and then, like, it gets revealed that, like, yeah, he speaks perfect English to his teammates, but he just doesn't want to do it. Like, you don't know. That's the thing.
I mean, this is just too much speculation, man. So much speculation on stuff that's not,
you
like,
know, we don't know.
Just,
we just
like
don't
per,
know.
Just
you
like
know.
We talked about in Professor Saltzman's class, we are gossiping.
Well, speaking of speculation, I think we should go around and give some little hot predictions. Give some hot takes for the baseball season. Casey, I'm gonna start with you. Sure. Give us a little hot take. We'll start off a little hot, a little sizzle, a little simmer, and then we'll get a little hotter. But give us a hot take for you to start off the
season. Like anything?
I mean, okay. It could be anything from a rookie of the year pick to a Cy Young to an MVP pick to a team that's gonna win their division.
I think we were talking about this a little bit off air. NL Central, I think, is a really interesting division. I think the Reds are gonna win it. I know we had this discussion.
Zero starting pitching. They don't have enough starting pitching to go either way.
Casey, did you not read the news this morning that Matt McClain was going to be out for a majority of the season?
It's one guy.
Wow.
It's one guy.
And Noelvi Marte suspended for PEDs for 80 games.
So judging if by the that Dodgers reaction, are, he nah, didn't
they still got Ellie Dela Cruz.
I did. No, I heard about that. But I who else in that division is better?
The Cubs.
Cubs are pretty damn good.
You have
stand on your hot take, man. Stand on
Didn't
business.
Steele just finish runner-up in the Cy Young?
What?
Justin Steele just finished as a runner-up for the Cy Young. I think the Cubs are a better team, like in terms of being more well-rounded.
I think they're a better team, but more towards the beginning of the season. They're going to fall off at the end.
You go.
But
Hunter Green is their ace.
Hunter Green's going to have a great year.
I mean, I like the optimism, but Hunter Green is your ace? I don't care how hard he throws.
No,
I mean,
Sexy Red's going to be at a Reds game. Tell him Sexy Red's going to be in town for one Cincinnati
Sexy
game.
Red's
going
to be
I'm
in
sure
town
she
for
will.
Red team. That's crazy. Imagine Sexy Red being in
I
Cincinnati.
I guarantee you that's good for at least they're going to that's at least plus 5 wins right there. Promise.
What about rookie? What do you guys think for rookie of the year? Cuz I was thinking Jackson Merrill, low key, like
we talked that on the last week.
We did?
Yeah. I remember.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think it was just us two, buddy.
Yeah, I don't think
that was just you guys talking about
that. Buddy boy.
I think the NL Rookie of the Year is a little bit is interesting. It's a little bit open, but I actually think as much as it pains me to say, I think I got to go with Younghoe Lee out there.
Why does it pain you to say it?
Because you're a Giants fan, and because I know this will make you smile from ear to ear.
I honestly would choose on the Giants for Rookie of the Year, Kyle Harrison over Younghoe Lee.
I don't know. I think. The Giants' biggest need, obviously, like they needed pitching, but they just needed a good, reliable bat, I feel. And I think Younghoe Lee is going to fit in this lineup really well. I think he's going to complement, you know, the likes of Matt Chapman
And he's leading off.
And Jorge Soler, right? He's going to get on base. I think he's going to be the main run provider, you know, run scored. Yeah. I think he's going to lead the team in that. So I wouldn't be surprised if Young Ho Lee, you know, the transition to the MLB this season, if he has a good one and wins MLB.
I'm interested to see
over Yamamoto. I don't think Yamamoto is going
to
win rookie of
the year. I'm interested to see, like, his plate discipline and see, like, how he translates to much faster pitching and whatnot. I mean, he is in the leadoff spot, and he is a great hitter. I think he'll hit probably close to the 300s if we're lucky. But I want him to work walks. I want him to steal bags. I want him to. I honestly don't know how good of a base stealer he is. I'm sure he's. I mean, he's fast. He's nimble. He's a great defensive guy. But I think honestly, my more hot take would be Kyle Harrison. I don't even know if that's a hot take because I think
it's like lukewarm. I would even say it's like room temp.
He's
top 10 in the rank.
He's the best left-handed like pitching prospect in baseball.
He's number 23 overall prospect.
Yeah, so I mean, him winning it wouldn't surprise me at all. But
he did have some rough games last year. He had a few gems. Spring he was great. So I don't know. Maybe he's the future ace. I don't know. We'll see. But
didn't at one point, like, not to stray away too far away from baseball, but you had Pods winning Rookie of the Year.
No, I said
you never did.
No, I never had. I said all rookie first team. That's what I.
And you still have him there?
Yes.
Okay. No, I'm just clarification. Clarification. Sorry.
I would have him all for rookie first
team. Genuine question.
All right, but what about for the American League? I mean, because Jackson Holliday is not going to make the opening day roster. I mean, he'll definitely make his appearance
at
some
point. Junior Caminero?
Like Junior Caminero because I think a month into the season, he'll be up at the big league team.
What about we didn't even talk about Jackson Chirio. On the National League side.
Yeah, with the Brewers. I mean, he had a really good spring training. I think he hit above 300. And this Brewers team, obviously, they don't really have much going for them. If he's healthy, he's going to play 160 to 160.
Yeah, he's going to get that
he's going to get the volume, certainly. I just don't think he's going to compete with the likes of, like, Young Ho Lee, Yamamoto, other guys in the NL. But I mean, to open it up in both leagues, I think the Rangers are going to have the two best rookies.
Like Wyatt Langford and...
With Wyatt Langford and Evan Clark this upcoming season. I think, and with the two of them, I mean, Wyatt Langford, I've been seeing so much hype going into the season. And obviously, he raked in spring training. He had the most doubles, I believe, and the most RBIs. He was hitting lights out and made the opening day roster after getting drafted last June.
That's the coolest part.
Which is unheard of. That's unheard of this season.
Like, I love baseball, but it's kind of, you know, it's fun, like, being with your team for years and seeing these guys come up through the system. But it kind of is a drag to, like, have to wait that long. It's worth it.
Yeah, no, it absolutely is. But that just shows how, like, dominant he has been. Coming out of, you know, college, being at Florida last season, to, you know, playing half a season in the minor leagues, just playing spring training, now be on the opening day roster. I think between Wyatt Langford and Evan Clark, the Rangers are going to have the two best rookies in all of baseball. But I actually think Evan Clark is going to win the Rookie of the Year over Wyatt Langford.
That is the most baseball statement ever. Sorry, but to say I love baseball, but and then like give a reason why baseball.
No, it's not. Drags. It's not something bad about it. It's the way the system has been for years. But
no, I want to
pose a question.
It needs skill, unlike basketball, where you could just start right away.
I want to pose a question. Who's gonna have a bounce back year this year?
Hey, like, wait! I didn't give my hot take.
Sorry, didn't see you over there.
Wow,
is that a short joke?
Maybe.
Duke can make that joke all he wants, but I'm taller than a lot of people here.
All right, stand up then.
I'm not saying up on live television. All right, let's do it. Anyways, my hot take is that the Tampa Bay Rays will finish last in the American League East.
I love it.
Boston.
You know what? I actually kind of like Boston's lineup. I think Boston's lineup.
Besides Debbie.
Tristan Cassis hit 26 home runs with an 856 OPS.
All right, 2 out of 9.
I think Story's going to have a nice bounce back here.
Who's pitching for them?
Besides Bell, who do they have?
Is that his name?
Giolito's out for the year.
They got my guy Cutter Crawford, bro.
Okay. I mean, I like Nick Pivetta, but.
What a baseball name.
Why are we talking about
there's nothing there? I mean, there's nothing there in the pitching side of things, sure. But I think their lineup can definitely compete with Tampa Bay's. And I'm looking at
the Rays are a playoff team.
No, they're not. This year. Incorrect. They're not going to make the playoffs this year.
I will not. They got worse. I will not support these. No, but all their, we don't spend money.
The guys are going to come back. Like, Jeffrey Springs is going to come back. Rasmussen is going to come back.
It's late. Late.
They're going to come back in the middle of the season. They, Rasmussen and Springs had season ending early.
Let's be real about the Rays. Glasnow was great, but he was always hurt, and they were still good without him. Very, very good without him.
They could win with anyone. It's the system.
It's the system.
I know, but they traded a guy who hit, what, 23, 25 home runs in Luke Rayleigh for Jose Caballero. That dude sucks.
I mean,
his only thing is speed. That was a horrible
trade.
Their
contending window.
Who's Richie Palacios going to do in the outfield? Jose Siri is a bum.
This is
the best burrito I've ever eaten.
What are you?
Okay, their contention window is like this. But I think this is the last.
Randy Rosarena is going to get traded during the season, in my opinion.
Depends on how they do.
He's gone.
Depends on how they do.
Can you be our resident like Rays hater from like now on? I think we've unlocked like one of your best characters by far.
Dude, they need to move out of trash booty St. Petersburg.
They're getting a new stadium.
That's why they can't no fans. Are they though, or was that denied?
It wasn't.
I don't know about that.
Okay.
They're gonna pull an Oakland A's and they're gonna be like,
no, it's different. It's different.
I have a hotter take. I have a hotter take than all
Blue
of
these. Blue Jays win the
division.
Wait,
no, wait. I want to hear Cameo. What is Cameo?
Blue Jays?
Yeah. Easily.
Oh, wow.
Easily.
Honestly?
Orioles.
Yankees and Orioles are gonna have a little sophomore slump.
They're gonna choke in
the
playoffs.
I love that from you, Christopher.
Wait,
I love
the Orioles are like a top three team.
Yeah, Chris. I don't know about
that. They might be top two. No, like, can you name me a better, like, especially with Burns now? I mean, I understand, like, in the bullpen, there might be some, a little bit. Like, Cano is going to have to be the closer this year because Bautista's out.
I've seen bullpens destroy teams that were really good. The Phillies teams of,
okay,
like,
they were horrible in the playoffs. They were horrible in the postseason. I'll give you that. But I think they're going to still come out swinging to
like,
the end of
the
year.
This is a 100.
They're not winning the World Series.
Team. Yeah.
They'll probably get out. I could see ALCS ceiling, honestly. But
they can make it to the dance. I don't have them winning it. I don't have them winning the American League.
I don't. It's experience for me. Experience, and then that's what they struggled with last year. Who do you think is going to bounce back?
Wait. I need to give my hot take real quick.
Sizzler.
One last hot take, and you know, staying with the teams winning division, you know, underperforming. The team coming out of the AL West this year is going to be the Seattle Mariners for the first time since 2001.
Woo! I like it.
And I am going to live by that.
I like that.
I think the Rangers coming off the World Series, they're going to have a little World Series hangover.
But you just raved about
them,
the rookies.
I have them missing the playoffs. I wrote about this. I said their like ceiling is 84 wins. That is the most like made of glass roster I've ever, top heavy, especially on the pitching side.
They lost
zero bullpen.
They lost Monty too.
Yeah, I know. You replaced Montgomery who did they just? They're gonna have like Dane Dunning as like their four or five. I mean, Scherzer.
Dane Dunning was pretty solid last year. Don't get me wrong.
I know, but
he didn't
have
a big of a role.
Yeah, I mean, you can't put this guy into like a high like as your game three, game four starter.
Wasn't he good in the postseason when
Smith
he? Hang on. Well, Dane Dunning was good in the postseason when he started. Look it up. He made a fantastic.
Yeah,
start
but okay.
On the spot
besides
a good start,
correct.
If it wasn't for the most clutch hitting by the Rangers, especially Adolis Garcia, like this Rangers bullpen blew. Like last year in the league, they were bottom five in bullpen ERA.
Their bullpen was not very good.
Will Smith.
Yeah, I mean,
Aroldis Chapman.
Hey, whatever happened to Cal Raleigh? Did you talk about the Mariners?
The big dumper.
The big dumper. Mariners,
dude.
Yep. Cal Raleigh.
Listen, you know about his dumper, huh, Cameo?
Dude, I don't even know what I can say on air right now. But basically, that call, what was it, two years ago? It was 2022,
yeah,
right?
For them to make the playoffs.
The walk-off?
Yeah.
Electric. My God. Like, I couldn't give a rat's ass about baseball, and I saw that clip on Instagram.
It was like a feel-good story. It was a sob story.
It was one of the greatest calls I've ever heard in my entire life.
Well, you know, I think the Mariners are going to run it back this season. I'm looking at their starting rotation right now, and I think they have
best in baseball.
A top three rotation in baseball. Come the end of the season, come September, a top one rotation in baseball.
Why later
top
on?
Two,
I think
not
it's
two.
Top one right now.
I mean, I think there are other rotations out there. You could argue like the Braves rotation is pretty top heavy, but
consistency
they have
some issues.
Very good pitchers in there. And Chris Sale, if he comes back to his dominant form, they have three aces
saying.
On with between Spencer Strider, Max Fried, and Chris Sale.
Isn't
I don't
Sale,
think Chris
Sale
is
isn't Sale
an
a
ace.
Fossil?
I think he's still an ace. When
he
he's healthy,
not for Atlanta.
Not for Atlanta.
No one can hit him. I mean, it just his sidearm, his lefty sidearm angle, it's no other pitcher throws that way. And it is
he's your comeback player, kinda.
I think if Chris Sale stays on the field, yeah, he can dominate with the Braves, I think. And as a Mets fan, I'm very worried about
what about the Braves bullpen?
Playing the Braves.
I think it's solid. I mean, they got good pieces like AJ Minter and Rossy Iglesias. I think they'll be fine. I think their bullpen will be fine no matter what. I mean, I don't. It's not going to be like, you know, overpowering, but I think it's going to be fine.
I'm looking for a big year for O'Neill Cruz. I think the Pirates have zero expectations this year. They brought in a bunch of vets. I think he's going to thrive this year.
Hey, one of my predictions.
Led spring training and home runs.
Sorry. I said last episode that the Pirates could potentially win the Central.
You know, Casey, I'm going to piggyback off you, and I'm going to say that O'Neill Cruz goes 30 for 30 this season.
I could see it.
Jeez. And he flirts with a 40 for 40 season.
Flirts.
If he stays healthy, I think he we're gonna be talking about it come September. He might be the sixth player of all time to get a 40 for 40 season.
I don't hate that. Yeah, I think, like I said, with Pittsburgh, it's like...
I mean, he just so far, obviously spring training is a very small sample size and you need to take it for granted, but he has 7 home runs and 46 at-bats and his OPS is well over 1,000. I mean, he is raking. His strikeouts are obviously still a pretty big problem. He's still striking out like a third of the time.
But it doesn't really matter when you're hitting home runs.
It doesn't matter
when
you're hitting home runs. And not only that, but it's been lowered each of the past 2 seasons. I think O'Neill Cruz, like you said, I think he's going to take a big stride this season. Not only is he going to, you know, play well, I think he flirts with a 40 for 40 season.
What's your guys' like favorite thing to call like a big hit? Because I always... One of my favorite things about this, there's dinger,
dong,
adios, rake, pelota.
There's raker, ding,
nuke,
dinger, dong, laser, nuke, laser, bomb,
pimp job,
moonshot,
go yard.
Love a going of the yard. Oh my god, that's one of my favorites.
Sayonara,
bye bye baseball.
I can't wait.
You can't
to have a Dodger dog.
It's out of here.
I can't wait to be at the stadium. No. All this is reminding me of is being in the. In the bleachers.
And drinking beer, is that right?
Oh, Modelo.
Whoa. Yep. Keep it PG on the show.
It's Modelo time, fool.
Tajin, a little bit.
Oh.
We'll see.
Yeah, I love going to Dodgers fans and Dodgers games and interacting with those fans.
Dude,
I'm going on Monday, so we got to see how that goes.
I live in the left field pavilion.
Okay, another Pirate, though, we didn't talk about. Cabrian Hayes.
Residency.
Second most hits in spring training.
He had an amazing second half to last season. There was that whole thing with his hitting coach. I mean, how he was seeing like a hitting coach outside of the Pirates system.
Are the Pirates the new Orioles?
Adios,
They could be, but not yet.
I don't think they have enough. Yet. Yeah, because I mean, Jared Jones had a really good spring training as well. He just made the big league team, and then obviously Paul Skeens.
At some point.
They still got Henry Davis too, right?
Think about the Orioles in like 2018. They were probably the worst in the league, but that it was building up. Same can go with the and they brought in vets like Ronald Odor
don't forget Aroldis Chapman.
Ah, the GOAT.
And Domingo Herman. All right.
Another GOAT.
It's all
jokes.
Game, it's 2023.
It's all jokes.
Okay, good.
All right.
He knew.
People.
He knew.
I'm up to date with their.
He's on his Instagram.
I went to the game the day before that.
I
missed it.
Don't ever view all this Chapman's Instagram story.
I mean,
oh my god.
Oh, hell no. Wasn't there like some, there was some tape or something? Or like,
no, Chris sent me, it was him with his grandma.
And oh. I
don't even want to know.
Just say it.
He was grabbing a handful.
Of his grandma? No, he wasn't.
Or his
bro.
Mom. I don't know what it was.
This doesn't make it any better.
How do you know it was his mom?
Stop trying to rationalize it.
Because he's older.
We're off in like 20 seconds. But that's how we're going to end this off.
What's your hot take? What's your hot take?
Oh, Mets to the moon.
Yes!
Oh, yes! No!
Moon, I swear to God.
They might finish below the Marlins.
You heard it here first.
They might finish below the Marlins.
I don't give
a damn
about baseball. Mets over everything.
Who's pitching for them? Besides their closer, who's pitching for them?
Catch us in a couple minutes.
That's a discovery that we'll find out later. Stay tuned, guys.
clearly the C block, but we got a little open discussion format.
Do you want to talk more baseball? We can if
we can talk. If, I mean, guys, if it comes up,
if you guys really want to, but like,
you know, I actually wanted to talk about baseball, but I want to talk about a specific thing that you'd be interested in.
What would I be interested in?
You know, it's Wednesday, so why don't we create a new segment right here, right now?
Ah, what is it? I love some good wordplay.
Walk off Wednesday. Walk up Wednesday.
Excuse me. Oh, no, you fumbled.
Walk up Wednesday.
Oh, you can't stutter.
Bro, I need to know, KMR, if you were a hitter stepping into that batter's box.
Oh, I know what this question is.
What song would you use to hype up the crowd? Or on the mound, too. You can give me two answers if you want. There's a method to the madness.
Off the dome piece, listen, I'll be damned. Okay, because I think this song. So I went through like a chubby kid journey, right?
Mm-hmm. Chubby kid journey.
Sob
chubby
story kid coming journey. Up.
Wow.
No, for real.
You were a chubby lad back in the day?
Bro. Logan.
You're chubby? You were chubby.
When I tell you.
No way.
Photo didn't happen.
Oh, I got photos that I am not proud to show.
If anyone's viewing this, verify if Camier was chubby.
I can verify if Connor was chubby. but point being, I don't need anybody else for reference. Point being, first, like, I think we would like weigh ourselves in elementary school for like some fitness testing and stuff.
The
like,
fitness grand pacer test. Not even just aerobic test.
But they did fitness testing like all throughout like elementary school, middle school, high school, whatever. For context, I was about in fourth, fifth grade, like over 100 pounds, like. I was like low-key pretty large and I was not very tall.
I think I was 48 pounds in fourth grade.
Yeah, you're wild.
I think I was 27.
No, you're wild. And I was at least 90 to 100 pounds in fourth, fifth
moly,
grade.
Holy guacamole.
No, why am I getting all these looks right now? Like I was some kind of fatty. I mean, I was.
Can you get to the point?
Respectfully. There was a song. You a hater, bro. What happened to all those times up there that you tell me I'm a father figure to you? What happened to that kind of energy? Exactly. Gagged. Anyways, point being, there was one song that got me through and I would run hills. I would go. That was all my distance running time where I actually lost 10 pounds from 7th to 8th grade. And you know what that song was?
What?
It was Till I Collapse.
Oh, by Eminem.
By Marshall freaking
That's
kind
of hard.
Bro.
I think the key to that, you got to have that, you know, that buildup in there for a little bit, but you got to make sure you get to the climax because that's a whole part of the, you know.
Doom, 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 doom. Nah, dude, rest in peace to Nate Dogg, but dude.
Oh.
Oh! I'm ready.
Now, Maddie.
Now, stepping up on the mound, number, what number can
I used to PA announce. Give me this.
Eight.
Number eight. Kamiar. Alrighty.
All right, wait, let me try. Wait, can you wave to the crowd real quick?
Yeah.
Now pitching for your shot. San Francisco Giants, numbers.
The lights are too bright.
That was good.
The brights are too light.
I used to PA announce, but for my high school.
The brights are too light, guys. The brights are too light.
Madison, that's great work from you.
Good job, Madison. That was good.
That's great work.
That's a good choice. I'm going to applaud you on that. That's a good way. You gotta get the crowd fired up.
I don't want people say, oh, so original, overused. But I'm like, that's like, I think a universal. If someone were to hear that shit, and like, I'm
whoa,
out there.
Whoa, what's your language, man?
We can.
Chill out, Casey. Chill out.
I'm just a kid, man.
Whoa. All right, don't pull this.
You're my
Al.
Kid.
Okay. All right.
Anyway, so hey, who else? Who? Casey, what's your walk-up song, man?
I would go "Dream On" by Aerosmith. I think like the chorus is just there. It is. Not like the beginning part. Like it's kind of like somber at the beginning, but when you get to like that chorus, it's like.
Sing with me.
Sing for the years.
Yeah.
Sing for the.
I think that'd be high. Like,
sing for the tears.
Like, I'll do like the warm-up.
Yeah.
Songs.
Do. Wait. Walk out.
It's gone time.
Now batting. Now batting for the San Francisco Giants. Number 28.
Rogan,
Kaslinner.
There you go. Lean with it. Rock with it.
Time. Call on time like six times so I can sing the song.
Bro,
Strike three. You're out.
Isn't that the new baseball? You can't do that.
Pitch clock doesn't.
You get one.
Me.
You can get one.
Three is overkill.
I used to do it a lot, but okay, Logan, how about you?
All right. I think, I mean, I played baseball in high school. So, like, we actually had a chance to, like, do walk-up songs. And right after Uzi released his, like, Eternal A-Take,
I'm listening.
Gary's tweaking right now.
I'm listening. My walk-up song is Baby Pluto.
Which
I thought it was pretty hype. But now, if I were to have a walk-up song right now at this moment, it's Unwritten.
Oh!
You're telling me? Dude, if you walk up right now,
it's actually so hype. I see
everyone's getting lit right there. I mean, I don't know about y'all, but this would be my walk-up song right now, and I would own it.
That's a great pick. I think you can either go the hard route where you're getting pumped up, or you can go to the parody route where you pick a song like this, which
gets the crowd pumped up.
Exactly.
And for me, if the crowd's getting pumped up, that's all I need. Like I don't need music to pump me up. If the crowd is like, oh yeah, like this is lit, you know, getting turned up, I'm getting turned in the box too. That's all I'm saying.
Timmy Turner.
God, if anyone picks that other walkout song, I'm leaving.
All right, Matt, you got it.
So I played baseball in high school too. So I had like a pitching song and a walk-up song. So for pitching, mine was "Touch the Sky" by Kanye West. But now I wouldn't do that because
you get canceled.
I mean that too. But I mean, like, I mean, my boys know. Like every time they heard that song, they knew like and I was getting pulled. Coach is coming out to the mound. Like, yeah, get this fella out of here because it was not the greatest.
I know Matt was throwing 90 ched.
What was your top velo?
Dude, I threw 80 poo. That was like
80 and flat.
No, like maybe
what was
a little
your
stuff?
What like what type of stuff?
Well, I mean, if I knew where it was going, it would be like a fastball, a slider, a changeup.
Oh, there you go.
Come over to the spot with Tony.
This is still one of my favorite songs of all time.
So I might rock with it, it might remind me of my senior year on the mound. So I don't know if I would do that.
Touch the sky.
But right now, I think if I were to come up to the plate, that new Metro song with all the beef.
Yes! Yes!
That is the best beat.
That beat goes hard. Thank you.
Dude, for Metro's standards, dude, that beat is...
He cooks.
That beat is generational.
What it's called like that.
Like
Future,
that.
Metro, Kendrick.
Fire on mute.
Dude, you got the beef? And then he says, screw the big three?
It's just Big Me.
Like, yes! Come on now. Like, imagine you're coming up, bags juiced, your team's down by three.
It's just me.
Come on.
Fire on mute, yeah.
Listen to this, Casey, please.
This is a classic sample.
With open ears, please listen to this.
What is this from?
Listen to the beat, please. It's just so good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Easy E's also sampled in this. That little kid voice in the background, that's from Easy E song.
Dude, this beat is just so good. Oh my God.
No, it's actually, the thing is, one of the greatest things I heard about like the Metro album, what's it, two like not this past December,
the superheroes and villains.
So superheroes and villains, right? The best review I'd ever heard and the best way someone was able to like put it towards what this album was, Sinister. Like I remember it would get dark early. I'd be driving back, like I was back home with my boys, and like it would be raining sometimes, dark, and we're just riding. Dude, I felt like I was about to do some sinister
crime. It makes you
crime.
Feel like that sinister that
crime
mofo.
I was about to pull. It makes me feel like I'm way harder than I actually am. And honestly, I love it for that.
That's what I'm saying. Like, that's the best amp up. Like, I mean, for right now. Dude, I've been playing this thing like five times a day, so I got to chill or else I'm going to like overplay the hell out of it. Before next week, I'm going to hear the beat and I'm going to be like, okay.
Even that intro? Lord.
That intro is good.
The piano on intro?
The whole cutting? Yeah. I mean, hey, you're going to hear that TOT formal. I put that on the playlist.
That shit is so tough.
Cameo
so
reminded good. Me to put it on the playlist. That song was so good. Dude, when that dropped, I was like, hell yeah. This is Kendrick at his peak. Dude, he's gonna come out and start dropping some more stuff now, which, you know, he's not going to go all, you know, hide back in the bushes like he did, like, you know. Like a true artist does, you know, they evaporate from the scene and then they rise up from the ashes again.
Like a phoenix.
Exactly. Like, that's a Jay-Z lyric.
Like a diamond?
Yeah. Speaking of that was on the Diamonds from Sierra Leone was the lyric that Jay-Z used, rising from the ashes like a phoenix.
Yeah, no ball.
Yeah. You sure do know hip hop, Casey, isn't that true?
Oh yeah, so totally.
Who's your favorite rapper?
My favorite rapper.
If you say Eminem, I'm gonna actually start laughing.
Why would I say Eminem?
No, wait, that's not even a bad answer.
Yeah, why would I say Eminem?
That's not even a bad answer.
I'm not, but okay, but you know why the reason? No, you know why I would laugh at Eminem. Okay, keep going.
I can't think of one I like. Like, it's really.
You don't like anything.
No, it's terrible. Okay, what's yours? Walk up song.
Okay. Anyways, I thought you were talking about what my favorite rapper is, but okay. I mean, I think it depends on. I think if I'm playing in a big city, I would want to go with an artist from that big city. Mm. But you know,
you gotta stick to your hometown, man.
Okay, but
that is his new hometown.
Correct. But what kind of artist? Home. What kind of artist comes from Rancho Santa Margarita, California?
Lil Dicky.
The only thing. The only thing I could play really is that. I mean, Zach De La Roca went to high school with my mom, so I could do Rage Against the Machine. That's my kind of connection. But anyways, sure. Let's go. You know, Pete Alonso uses Walk Up Song in New York City, which is insanely hard.
What is this?
I'm going Shook Ones. Part two.
Everybody from the 313.
Follow me.
Exactly.
I've seen the movie.
Man, I mean, I was talking to my dad about this. I'm like, this has got to be the hardest hip-hop beat of all time. In my opinion, the way it comes in like this, you just know it's going to be just dropping, you know, cold, just amazing all over the place. And I love the lyrics always, you know, they always stick with me as well. I'm only 19, but my mind is older.
That's relatable for you, right?
it's definitely not relatable for you.
What do you
so
mean?
Relatable.
You're 19 and your mind is Lord knows
how. You don't know about me.
Lord knows how young your mind is.
There's a lot of things you don't know about me.
I'm only 19 and my mind is old, and when the things get real, my warm heart turns cold. My crew is featherweight, my gunshots will make you levitate. This dude, you know, prodigy.
Sounds kind of violent.
That's the whole point of the song, dude. You're supposed.
Are we for peace here? Come on.
Okay. Anyways, prodigy.
Yeah, mature, man.
Prodigy and Havoc.
Get with the program.
They were amazing, but yeah, I would come up with that hip hop song. I gotta cut it right. You know, the intro would be kind of dope. If I take a long walk to the batter's box, you gotta let it play out, man. That's the whole point.
Okay.
But, and pitch in terms of, you know, if I was on the mound, right? I have a method to the madness here. If I'm on the mound, I want a song that gets me, you know, that gets a crowd fired up when I'm walking out of the bullpen and I come out that fence.
Oh, there was nothing better than Timmy Trumpet. Exactly. There was nothing better.
Something like that, right?
All right, so then what's your favorite ones of all time? Pitching walkout, like for a closer.
I mean, Timmy Trumpet's was good. I mean, I'm not a big Hell's Bells guy. I thought Mariano did it better. Yeah, I think so too. But I think, you know, I'm going to go with another rock ballad, but no one really knows this, I feel like. Maybe you do, Casey.
What?
Ozzy Osbourne?
Yeah.
But not Crazy Train.
What song?
Mr. Crowley.
Oh, yeah.
I think I was listening to this. I mean, I know it has a long intro for sure. Mr. Crowley does.
We can skip to the part. I mean, you have a minute, right? Yeah. I mean, what's it with the pitch clock? Minute?
Exactly. But I would skip it to the part where you got 10 seconds of only the organ playing, and it's just boom, and then the synth goes up, and then he starts singing Mr. Crowley, and it's boom, 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 and then it's just the guitars kick in, and then, you know, it's just powerful stuff. I think I think that would be a cool one. I don't think everyone's ever used it.
Yeah, there you go.
Damn.
Okay.
This is kind of spooky, right? I mean, this is kind of spooky.
Some vampire
stuff. Via request. We have a question from Madison. If you could only listen to one song for the rest of your life, what is that song?
I did it.
I'm consulting the playlist.
I also might have to consult the playlist.
I don't need a
playlist. All right. I have two options that come top to mind. Right now,
Sanguine Paradise.
Kidding. Should be throwing money in this bottle.
What's
the lyric where she's like, isn't it like she eats me like a fish stick?
That's music.
Like a fish stick. I don't want to say the whole thing.
It's bars.
Yo, girl, do my tartar sauce. Oh yeah, that's
awful. Let's not forget.
That's heinous.
That was tough.
Speaking
was
of bad tough. Lyrics, I just want to talk about the Big Sean lyric. Has anyone ever heard it?
No.
It's so bad. I don't know if I want it. There's no curse words involved, but just the purely thought.
It's wild.
Yeah, the pure thought of this lyric is just awful. I don't know if I want to say this, but it's
well, kinda, thanks for freaking blue ball and all this. Like, I thought I was going to hear some
ages. It's kind of funny. It's like, put that thing on my groin, make it go boing, boing.
Wow, that is all-time bad. So Logan, what are we
in middle school? Like, this is good music?
Come on. No, we all agreed that it was just bad.
That's every rap song, bro. That's like some.
No, that's not every rap song. Okay, anyways, go.
Right. So two songs. One was already said earlier by Hayes, and that is American Pie by Don McLean.
Good song.
Man. I know every single word to that song. It's an 8-minute song.
I think it's got a good meaning too.
I think that'll suffice me for a long time because it goes 8 minutes long, and I do know every word to it.
I don't know. I think I like American Pie, but I just think at some points it goes like a little too slow for me to be listening.
Absolutely, it's a sad song though.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it's just
do I want to be sad though? The rest of my life.
Crash, dude.
Do I want to be sad the rest of my life though?
I mean, look, it's a good song, and it goes for 8 minutes. So I mean, I rock with it. Another song that I know all the lyrics to. Dreams and Nightmares by Meek Mill. That's a song that I could listen to.
You get
to
two
every
aspects.
Single
you get
day.
The
hold on, wait a minute.
Y'all thought
I was finished?
When I bought
that. I'm sure that's what Diddy thought.
Oh my goodness. Like, you get two parts of such a majestic song.
Without an album.
Man, what's your guys' thought? What's your...
Dreams
and Nightmares by Diddy's boyfriend in the chat. It's crazy. Crazy. Yeah, what's your guys' take on that? Because, like, the whole thing, like, does that make you, like, listen to him less? Because I remember when the Kanye stuff came out, and, like, I mean, I listened to Kanye my whole life, and I
realized... Careful with your words here, man.
I know. I realized... I don't agree with everything that he says. Of course, like, all the stuff that he says... I don't agree with all the stuff that he says.
He's just trying to get on
you. He's trying to make me cancel. But point was, I realized I was listening to him less ever since that stuff came out. But it wasn't by choice.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. It was by just like my brain. I'm like, I was listening to him less.
But no, I'll be honest. Like, whether this is a lukewarm, hot, cold, I don't know what temperature of take this is. I think ever since like I considered the fall off or like the line of Ye, and I've told this to like some of my friends.
Yay.
Once he passed the point of no return, I really also think it's just a fake. Like, I don't think musically he's what people are like resting on the laurels of like what he used to be musically.
So would you say The Life of Pablo was his last like good work?
No, I would even go I
like
would,
Kids See Ghosts.
I would go past. Kids See Ghosts is still good work.
Okay. Yeah, it was.
You know, Talk of Troy's right. Separate art from artist. Yeah,
which is fine.
I do that.
Fine.
Okay. I do that. Right. But
like, even though Ye was short, I loved Ye.
No,
like, Ghost Town is one of my favorite songs.
No,
that's probably one of my least. And hit that, you know, got whatever gospels, whatever. The
hell, that's when we started.
Separate art from artist only goes so far, though. Like when you're advocating for hate on a group, I think that's a little too far.
Yeah, true. But I know I'm just saying that. Like,
but then where does the line?
I still listen to him, but I realize I'm listening to him less.
But I'm saying even regardless of like his shenanigans and his like and his beliefs
tomfoolery
and all that,
and
all that stuff, baffled. Not to like downplay it or anything.
Careful with your words.
I really relax.
I'm kidding, by the way.
I really think like musically, I think people just have this idea of what he used to be, and they keep trying to force like this notion of the stuff that he puts out now, like.
I think Carnival's a terrible song.
Oh,
like it's not like I won't say these things.
Dude, just think about the lyrics that what's his face Ty Dolla $ign sing. Go, go, go. Like that the whole
so,
part.
So
that
now
whole
you see my
sucks.
Perspective on like all these songs.
No, your perspective but here's
is completely
the thing.
Wrong.
Kanye,
I don't want to hear your
Kanye
perspective.
Kanye was one of the best artists. Period. When he was his first three albums. And then, you know, My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. Like, that whole, like, kind of run in the 2000s, 2010s.
See, I don't agree, but okay, carry on.
Well, because you don't listen to anything
No, I have. You guys don't know. In middle school, I used to listen to rap.
But what rap? You never...
Kanye, even. I used to as a kid, and I never liked... I did it to fit in, and then I realized, like, this shit sucks.
Nah, to be fair, I'm actually so fair. I listened to rap in high school to, like, fit in with all, like... All my boys were just into like Uzi and you know, Lil Baby,
middle school.
Baby and all that stuff. And then as soon as I got to college, I have barely listened to rap. Like, I mean, aside from like a little bit of Uzi and like some Drake and Kanye that like I listen to that are like just like iconic songs, I don't like listen to
I
like,
guess that's,
Lil Baby,
I mean, I guess that's
Baby,
true. But like, like for me, like both my parents love hip hop and rap. Like they're big hip hop heads. My dad, you know,
it's based on your parents.
From New Jersey. I mean,
no,
he loves, you know,
for a lot of people it is.
I mean, my dad loves rap and he loves rock and like my mom likes the same thing. So that's just kind of my influences. And yeah, I agree with Madison because the rap game is weak right now, and this is why Kendrick just rejuvenated it.
What is the okay?
It is weak. Come on, you got guys out here. What's his name? YBN Kosher. What?
Bro,
come on, that dude's trash. I was talking about this at my work. YBN Kosher. You got guys like that. You guys like all the sound is sounding too familiar.
Do you know the?
Because anyone can do it.
Playboy Cardi also fell off a cliff
do
too.
Do you know the only difference with the rap game now and the rap game back in the day, okay?
They had more people beefing. Is that what you're going to say?
No, the only difference is the people that we all look at as trash and that blow up for 30 seconds on Instagram and TikTok or whatever, the only reason those people exist is because of that's just the age and you don't need a label
anyone can
to
do
get
it.
Music
Anyone
out.
Can do it, yeah.
No, that's anyone can put out music.
It doesn't take talent, dare I say it.
No, it doesn't take talent to put out music either.
To play a guitar and sing and perform, yeah.
But to chop beats and use a synthesizer,
go on GarageBand and drag a loop.
So you're basically saying it takes a baboon to make a beat. So what Metro does is
I
he's
didn't
a
say that, but
no. But effectively, Casey, what you're saying
so
is
are
that
you, are you saying that current Vince Neil and Axl Rose are talented?
Yes.
Right now.
What do you mean right now?
Because they suck right now. What do you mean? Have you ever seen them perform? They can't perform anymore.
Because they're older. And they've, honestly, a lot of people in rock, the
okay,
drugs
well, that's
are a
the same thing. All the artists progress, all the artists downgress when they get
older. But the message
we're talking
in rap
about.
No, they don't preach it in their songs, but a lot of these guys had downtrot, like, really hard times because performing is really hard to do.
Okay, and rapping it hot live is also really hard to do. I'm people that and
Drake
people,
sitting courtside at every game, is that really a hard life? I don't know.
I'm saying like, rapping Drake.
Wait, what is this? Why are you acting like big
there's
band?
No struggle. Like in rock, there's so much more of a struggle.
What do you mean there's no what?
Wait, tell
all these rock stars
tell,
are looking
hey, rest in peace to Nipsey Hussle. Tell him there was no struggle. What are you talking
I
about?
I didn't say no.
Wait, what are you talking about?
Grill him.
Okay, what about
grill him.
Tell
Randy Rhodes who died in a plane crash. Everyone you can name, I can name one as well. It's no different.
Yeah, just
so
like,
then that disproves everything you're saying.
It was different back then. It's nowadays.
What's different back?
Making it big was so much harder in the glory days of music because nowadays anyone can catch a stride and get big based
even
on clicks.
Even okay, but you realize in the glory days of music hip hop was still around and you still would shit
talking,
on that
okay,
regularly.
To clarify, I didn't mean struggles in life or death. I meant struggle as in financially and making it big and making it out a lot. And same could go for rap, like
okay exactly like,
okay,
so the
any,
same
anyways,
could go for rap
no
anyways,
no old rap like I'm not like Tupac like those types of guys that I genuinely respect more and that took more skill. But I'm talking about guys today, like you're trying to say that Drake has a struggle or like any of those guys who like are flashing
their
money.
Drake's been around for
what
years.
What are you talking about? Hey,
there's other guys who have been around less who have the same situations.
That's true. I mean, yeah,
a lot of those rock guys aren't rich. Like they're even the ones that are alive today.
Oh, because they blowed all the money. Let's be
no,
real.
No, a lot of them fell into addiction problems and stuff. Because
well, that's their fault. Again, they blow the money.
I'm not about to blame addiction.
That's kind of a generalization.
I don't know. Let's talk about, I mean, didn't Vince Neil kill someone as well? That's another thing that
he lost
money on.
Some of them are bad people. I'm not saying that. But a lot of them, they don't preach bad messages in their song. Like
no, yeah, they're not hungry anymore. Exactly right, talkoftroy Instagram account or YouTube account in the comments.
I mean, you can't tell me that rap songs preach. Like I'm not gonna generalize all of them, but most of the ones, probably the ones.
Why do you think rock preaches anything else except they use their words more carefully?
They don't. I listen to rap every day. It's a lot more storytelling and it's a lot more like, it's less violence.
This is the most like, bro. What do you think of Elvis? What do you think of like his music?
Love songs and stuff. It's not. I don't think it's like great storytelling, but I don't. I also don't want to listen about like to like profanity and like. And
hey,
like violence.
Hey, talkoftroy YouTube account is saying, Casey, stop. Elvis stole
what's
black culture.
What's intelligent about listening to songs about weapons and
have you
violence
listened, have
and
you
profanity?
Ever listened to a Kendrick Lamar song? He talks about his experience growing up in poverty and gang culture.
I don't even
and how he got
with,
out
I don't
of
even
it.
Mess with Duckworth like that, but just
no,
listen to Duckworth.
There, like I said, there's certain examples that I said this before. I'm not going to generalize everyone, but a lot of
there's
rap
also,
songs.
There's also examples. That, there's all bad examples. There's bad apples in every single category.
There's
I'm
a
telling
lot more.
Right
yeah,
now.
But I think Casey does have a point here. With rap, I mean,
there's a lot of bad.
I go to the gym every day and I'm listening to rap and I'm like really listening. I'm like.
And like,
damn, what kind of message is he really putting out there right
now?
Well, that's
not,
because of what you listen to, by the way. Because rap is the number one genre in the United States, so you're gonna listen to more of that. You
is
know,
it, is pop not bigger?
No,
Taylor
look it
Swift,
up. Rap has been
Dua Lipa,
the biggest genre in
Billie
the
Eilish.
No, the rap has been the biggest genre in the United States for a few years now. You can go look this up. It's been a known fact that it's been the biggest genre in the United States for a few years because obviously rock fell off. Pop didn't have stars, and the pop stars weren't good, like Meghan Trainor and like all these, you know. Industry plant pop stars like Meghan Trainor was a big one. Annie Grammer.
No,
I
wasn't doubting you. I was just wondering.
No,
but...
I'm just saying. Anyways, let's go back to the original conversation we were having about, you know, picking one song out of listening to the rest of your life. More calm conversation.
I forgot that was a question.
I can't believe I got called the bimbo in the chat room. That's besides the point.
No, he was agreeing with us. He was agreeing with us, Cam Yard.
I know it's not a popular opinion.
I'm honestly so tired. I wish I lived 40 years ago.
I don't know who this Jonathan character is. I think the voice of God from talkoftroy is really so trying tired, to speak
bro.
To us.
I'm so exhausted of trying to like convince
people.
Okay, let
me just say something.
No. Let's go back to that. Let's go back to the original topic.
Can I just say one closing thought?
Okay.
I know I'm in the minority. I have an unpopular opinion. And like, I'm not going to change it just because of that.
Okay.
But I know people love rap.
You don't need to change it, but I think you just need to respect it.
Why do I have to respect it? I don't like it. Like,
because it takes talent and you don't realize that.
I don't think it does. Like, genuinely. Okay. I think it takes talent just as like a lot of things do, but I don't think it takes the same level of talent.
Anyways, let's go back.
Logan, I know I'm not in the popular opinion. I don't care.
Low key agree. More than low key. What's the middle?
Be so real, man.
Well, I mean, he's got a great point with saying like,
yeah.
I mean, the message thing.
Bro,
if you choose like 10 rap songs at random and see what kind of message they're putting out there, it is the same exact thing.
It's hateful. You've guys inspired me. I will do my own dedicated research and my own dedicated case study. And I'll ask you after the show your favorite bands and a list of 10 to 15.
I have
the
list up.
Well, it's not
fantastic. I'm going to get all of them. I'm going to look at their most popular hits, and I'm going to see really what the message was behind what they were talking
okay.
about.
Let's not talk about how Motley Crue was talking about misogynistic songs.
I don't listen
here.
To them, but okay.
Oh, you literally said you did that last week.
Isn't that picky choosy? Like,
I love Motley Crue too, but I mean, you have to recognize.
Just be objective.
Okay, there's a difference between listening to like two songs by them and listening to the artist. There's a very big difference.
All right, anyways, can we go back to the original conversation, please? Please, for the dear love of my mother, please. Let's get Matt. You know, Logan went off. Or do you want Casey to go pick his song?
There's no point. Like, you guys aren't gonna know.
No, Go ahead.
I'm gonna hear an ear. Okay. Well,
is this Squeeze?
Well, they're my favorite band. I have 45 songs of them in my playlist.
Okay, get what's the song you need to listen to the rest of your life?
It would be hard. Like, probably Separate Beds. I like the message. Yeah.
Can you explain to me what the message
is? you want to hear? Okay. The message is, it's about a young couple and the...
So this is like the Pina Colada song, essentially.
No, it's not. It's nothing like that.
Oh,
it's,
not, uh-huh.
it's, okay, it's about a young. Listening. It's about a young couple and the guy is trying to like please the parents because they're like super strict.
Mm-hmm.
And the parents won't let them like go out together. So mm-hmm. the separate beds, like they have to like be in separate beds. And mm-hmm. and it's like, it's all in England. So like the culture's a little different, but,
mm-hmm.
and talks about how like the mom doesn't like him, but the dad, like it's just a story. It just goes on. That's what British music is all about. That's why I love British music, because it's all about storytelling.
Huh.
And it's not
like
about drugs. And
almost like Dave doesn't tell good stories, but I mean,
thank
that's
you.
A,
thank
that's
you.
A, that's a
who's
story
Dave?
For another.
Dave's a rapper.
No problem. Okay. No problem.
He does tell good. You can no go problem. Watch his performance no on the BET Awards.
That guy
that
tells
was,
some
that
crazy
was pretty impressive.
Stories.
But yeah, but anyway. I mean, it is true. He does have some songs where it kind of just fits like, you know, the general like rap stuff. But like, yeah, that dude's a definite storyteller. You know, yeah. Some UK rap can pop up. Skepta. I'm a big Skepta fan. Did listening that goes hard. I'm not gonna lie. Like Konnichiwa, that album was great, and then you know, Skepta's a good man. What about you, Kamiar? Got one song you need to listen to for the rest of your life?
I don't know. It'd have to like I could go different routes. Like it could be something goofy. It could be like
goofy
a Drake song, or it could be like,
well, just how many songs are you thinking? What's your short list,
bro? Honestly, like I don't know why I'm inspired, but like it could just be Am I Wrong
by Nico and
no
Vince.
No way. Like that song just came on earlier.
No,
like,
because
that,
like
it's
on
it's
coming
it's
from,
on
bro.
It
it's
is
top of
it
mind.
Is like that's why like when I played it I was like
goofy funny song.
No,
that you
I could really just
such a good
I could
song.
Really just
they fell off a cliff too. What happened to them? They were one hit wonders.
Cliff, I mean, like
they were one hit wonders, but actually no, they got like two, three. But like,
no,
still.
I couldn't name you another song.
If you listen to it.
Like, dude, this song just, like, tickles my brain now. It just tickles my brain. It feels so good.
I mean, if you look at their Spotify profile and you hit that number two, number three, I think you've heard it before. I don't remember the name of it, but.
It's so good.
It just reminds me of soccer from FIFA. I mean, it was not in FIFA, but it just reminds me, you know, the vibe.
It might be like, yeah, it might be like a FIFA 15.
Like, it sounds like a global song that can be, oh.
I mean, this was definitely awesome.
I still listen to this on like a daily basis.
Madison's trying to trigger something right now. He did mention it earlier in the chat, though. Passion Fruit.
Ah, low key, like, there are simpler times, bro. And I was like, I think I was, for the longest time, this song had to, like, for whatever reason, grow on me.
I'm the same way. When I first heard this song, I was like, and then I got into the groove a little bit. I'm like, oh, this is kind of danceable, you know?
No, but I think.
I don't think Drake's lyrics do anything on this. I think, yeah, but I think you're just there for the vibe.
No, fuck that.
I think you're just there for the vibe.
What he said.
Fuck that shit.
Oh, no. Player, you knew that was coming.
Yeah, I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I think those are solid.
Listen, nah, me and you just got, bro.
I think that's a good karaoke song, Passion Fruit.
Oh, I mean, dude, if we're gonna go on the list of karaoke songs, honestly, I don't know if you know this one song, Oceans with Jay-Z and Frank.
Ooh. Can you?
I don't know if you know Ocean. It's on the Magna Carta. Like, hold.
That's an underrated Jay-Z album.
I don't even listen to Jay like that, but he's like. That's dope boy still smelling like cocaine. And it's so tough.
Yeah, that's the same album with Holy Grail, am I right?
Yeah, I think so.
That song is pretty underrated. I remember when that came out, and then I was like, JT's vocals were good. This is Oceans?
Yeah. Blessings, yeah. No, it's actually so... No, I need to listen to some more. I think this is some weirdo remix, but like...
Some weirdo remix.
I didn't remember that tingle in the background, but maybe it was always there.
Damn. All right.
No, but yeah, this song that's crazy. This song was gas.
Some tingle wingle. Yeah,
we need to freestyle more on this show, by
the
way.
No.
We need to.
Dude, I need to not freeze.
After that Chris Pavona freestyle last time, I'm not sure we're going to ever do that again.
Honestly, I would take... For whatever reason, Logan, I think you could spit. I think if you're inspired, and I think if you
he's
have...
He's from New Jersey.
I'm telling you right now, you are so wrong.
you're from New Jersey. You can spit a little bit.
I'll see you tomorrow, and we'll see...
I'll see you tomorrow.
We'll see how it is at the TOT formal, man.
Oh, wow. What a little preview.
I just thought of this idea
literally 3 seconds ago before we, like, sign off for the day. Should we, like... make content out of tomorrow? Like, should we, like, vlog the thing?
I agree.
There's going to be so much incriminating stuff.
Oh, you already plan on doing that? I'm out of the loop. But, like, is there going to be, like, how do we do it, Madison? Like, is there, like, an intro? Like, are we just going to cut a bunch of crap together? Like, oh, you got it on lock type?
Just don't let Ben... let Ben Papp get
the
camera.
No. Bro, it's not going to be too belligerent. All right. It's going to be nice.
Let me get to my song.
Oh, yeah. Go for it.
Just don't let Ben Papp touch that camera. Ben Cap. Anyways, I think, you know, I gotta go.
Your guys' beef is crazy.
Okay. We don't have beef. I've never had beef. This is it right here. This is my favorite band of all time. It's actually just one guy. Tame Impala. Let It Happen. This is a 7-minute masterpiece. You got three sections in here. You know, I love songs that just, you know, they have that kind of cross. They have three sections, or they have multiple sections. You know, it's multiple songs in there. This is one of them. You know, I gotta pick. I'm a big, you know, this kind of like, you know, 80s sounding vibe. I love the 80s sounding vibe. I know I might throw Madison for a curveball here with this one, but one song I've been listening to really much is "Policy of Truth" by Depeche Mode.
Who?
Don't say who to Depeche Mode. Look up Have you never heard "Just Can't Get Enough"?
Oh, that's them. Oh,
all I never wanted. About it
every night. That's
what?
Them.
No. Oh. What? That's
a that song's lit though.
That's a Black Eyed Peas.
Oh. Oh yeah, I was gonna be like, that cannot be this Depeche Mode character.
This is Depeche Mode. I like this. It's kind of haunting, little sleek, sexy 80s groove. Casey, you like Depeche Mode, right? Oh, well,
not an approval.
I was trying to get him into it. I think this
I was trying to get him into it.
I think, you know, I also gotta go, you know, rock, rap. These are kind of like in the more electronic rap, rock stuff. But I think if I gotta go a rock song, I think it's gonna be my number one karaoke song. It's gotta be Your Love by The Outfield. Come on.
Josie's on a vacation far away. I don't wanna be like a party pooper here, but that was like four songs when we were talking about the one song.
Sorry. I didn't know I was gonna get four songs too, realistically.
I'm sorry.
No, it's chill. No, you'll get them next time, Tiger.
I got fun time out. Tiger, okay. Okay, buddy boy. All right, let's get, slugger. All right, let's go, sis. All right, name your song.
All right, I know we were on the Kanye track earlier, but I mean, this song is just like, every time I hear it, it's just like a mood booster. It has to be Gold Digger by Kanye.
I know damn well.
Dude,
I know damn well you didn't just.
Wait. Why?
It's a basic Kanye pick.
I'm not saying like it's bad at all.
No, it's not bad. I think it's a basic Kanye song though.
Okay.
For the rest of your life, I think you'd get annoyed as shit as Jamie Foxx.
I say she a gold digger.
Like you get annoyed.
No, because I've been listening this since the beginning days.
Broke,
so
not,
I
don't, but not
I,
as you, I've but never, not as your lone
girl,
song.
But ahead, I've down. Never gone sick.
Get down, girl. Go ahead, get down.
He, this is
get down,
this
girl.
Is
go ahead, get down. Get down, girl.
No, okay. If you wanted me to go on like the older side,
I can tell you rock. I can tell by your charm, by his girls you got a flock. I can tell by your charm and your arm. Have you looking for the one? Have I seen her? My psychic. Well, I can't say the word. Serena, Trina, Jennifer. For Lopez, four kids, and gotta take all the bad. The showbiz. All right. That's enough.
My ears. You know, I challenge that this message is better than that two separate Bez nonsense that you were talking about.
Yeah, this is okay. This
message.
I did agree with Casey earlier about how like a lot of rap has like a bad message.
It's a story. It's not the same thing.
This is kind of a message and a story.
Your thing, bro.
I said my song has a story. I didn't say it has a good message.
Okay, that's fine. This story is better than your story.
What's the story?
The story is a gold digger.
It's
a gold digger.
This is his life.
A gold digger.
I told a much scaled down. I would probably take me a long time to like analyze every lyric.
Oh,
but,
all right.
I mean, she take my money. I mean, you can go pretty deep into that.
When I'm in need.
There's a lot of different ways you can go with that.
Intelligent story. I was saying that over and over.
You're mopping
and over
the floor
and over again.
Next week. You're doing the fries. That's another lyric of that one. In
yeah,
gold
it's
digger.
Not.
You're working your way up through the system.
See, if you can't tell what it means right away,
I could tell.
It's not a good story.
I know what it means.
I didn't know what it meant when you said it.
Well, because you don't listen to that song.
Under a rock.
Thank you. Anyways, I think we've had enough. Is that right? We've had enough.
I think that's all the time that we've got today. Thank you guys all for tuning in. This has been the Talk of Troy, and we will see you guys on Friday for our next show at 3:00. Thank you.